You're tuned in to the Long Island Ducks Broadcast Network. Today's Long Island Ducks game broadcast will begin shortly. Every game this season will be broadcast live on the Long Island Ducks Broadcast Network with high-definition video and audio via Boxcast. Fans can tune into the game on the Ducks' official Facebook page and YouTube channel, as well as the team's official website, liducks.com. Thank you for tuning in, and stand by for complete coverage of today's game. 2017 Long Island Ducks season ticket packages are on sale now. Enjoy the best savings and most benefits available to cheer on your hometown team. 10-game mini plans are also on sale and offer fans the same great seats for 10 games throughout 2017, as well as many other exciting opportunities. To find out more information and secure your seats for the 18th season of Ducks Baseball, please call 631-940-3825 during normal business hours. The Bethpage Ballpark box office is now open for individual ticket sales. Box office hours are Monday through Friday from 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. and Saturday from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. Fans can also purchase their tickets by calling 631-940-TIXX or by visiting liducks.com and clicking on the tickets icon. The Ducks offer many packages available for groups with as little as 25 people to as many as 2,000. We offer block seating, pregame and in-game picnics, luxury suites, our exclusive Smoke and Al's party deck, and so much more. In addition, groups have the opportunity to take part in a variety of experiences, such as performing the national anthem or taking the field with the Ducks as the dream team. Group ticket packages for the 2017 season are now on sale. For more information on Ducks group outings, call 631-940-3825 or visit liducks.com. Looking for official Long Island Ducks merchandise, hard to find memorabilia, team apparel, and so much more? Then be sure to check out the Waddle In Shop, the official merchandise store of the Ducks. Fans can visit the shop online anytime at liducks.com by clicking on the merchandise icon. Store hours on game days are noon to 4 p.m. and during the game from inside the ballpark only. On non-game days, the store is open Monday to Friday from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. Children 14 and under can become members of the Bethpage Federal Credit Union Long Island Ducks Kids Club today. Kids will receive a unique gift package and take part in a variety of fun activities that come with being a member of the Kids Club. For more information on how to sign your child up, please call 631-940-3825 during normal business hours. Quacker Jack, the seven-time best Long Island mascot, is now available for appearances at parties and other special events throughout the Long Island community. Please contact the Community Relations Department at 631-940-3825 to find out more information and to book an appearance. Once again, thank you for tuning in to the Long Island Ducks Broadcast Network. Today's game will begin momentarily. You're tuned in to the Long Island Ducks Broadcast Network. Today's Long Island Ducks game broadcast will begin shortly. Every game this season will be broadcast live on the Long Island Ducks Broadcast Network with high-definition video and audio via Boxcast. Fans can tune into the game on the Ducks' official Facebook page and YouTube channel, as well as the team's official website, liducks.com. Thank you for tuning in, and stand by for complete coverage of today's game. 2017 Long Island Ducks season ticket packages are on sale now. Enjoy the best savings and most benefits available to cheer on your hometown team. 10-game mini plans are also on sale and offer fans the same great seats for 10 games throughout 2017, as well as many other exciting opportunities. To find out more information and secure your seats for the 18th season of Ducks Baseball, please call 631-940-3825 during normal business hours. The Bethpage Ballpark box office is now open for individual ticket sales. Box office hours are Monday through Friday from 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. and Saturday from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. Fans can also purchase their tickets by calling 631-940-TIXX or by visiting liducks.com and clicking on the tickets icon. The Ducks offer many packages available for groups with as little as 25 people to as many as 2,000. We offer block seating, pregame and in-game picnics, luxury suites, our exclusive Smokin' Al's party deck, and so much more. In addition, groups have the opportunity to take part in a variety of experiences, such as performing the national anthem or taking the field with the Ducks as the dream team. Group ticket packages for the 2017 season are now on sale. For more information on Ducks group outings, call 631-940-3825 or visit liducks.com. Looking for official Long Island Ducks merchandise, hard-to-find memorabilia, team apparel, and so much more? Then be sure to check out the Waddle In Shop, the official merchandise store of the Ducks. Fans can visit the shop online anytime at liducks.com by clicking on the merchandise icon. Store hours on game days are noon to 4 p.m. and during the game from inside the ballpark only. On non-game days, the store is open Monday to Friday from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. Children 14 and under can become members of the Bethpage Federal Credit Union Long Island Ducks Kids Club today. Kids will receive a unique gift package and take part in a variety of fun activities that come with being a member of the Kids Club. For more information on how to sign your child up, please call 631-940-3825 during normal business hours. Quacker Jack, the seven-time best Long Island mascot, is now available for appearances at parties and other special events throughout the Long Island community. Please contact the Community Relations Department at 631-940-3825 to find out more information and to book an appearance. Once again, thank you for tuning in to the Long Island Ducks Broadcast Network. Today's game will begin momentarily. You're tuned in to the Long Island Ducks Broadcast Network. Today's Long Island Ducks game broadcast will begin shortly. Every game this season will be broadcast live on the Long Island Ducks Broadcast Network with high-definition video and audio via Boxcast. Fans can tune into the game on the Ducks' official Facebook page and YouTube channel, as well as the team's official website, liducks.com. Thank you for tuning in, and stand by for complete coverage of today's game. 2017 Long Island Ducks season ticket packages are on sale now. Enjoy the best savings and most benefits available to cheer on your hometown team. 10-game mini plans are also on sale and offer fans the same great seats for 10 games throughout 2017, as well as many other exciting opportunities. To find out more information and secure your seats for the 18th season of Ducks baseball, please call 631-940-3825 during normal business hours. The Bethpage Ballpark box office is now open for individual ticket sales. Box office hours are Monday through Friday from 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. and Saturday from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. Fans can also purchase their tickets by calling 631-940-TIXX or by visiting liducks.com and clicking on the tickets icon. The Ducks offer many packages available for groups with as little as 25 people to as many as 2,000. We offer block seating, pregame and in-game picnics, luxury suites, our exclusive Smokin' Al's party deck, and so much more. In addition, groups have the opportunity to take part in a variety of experiences, such as performing the national anthem or taking the field with the Ducks as the dream team. Group ticket packages for the 2017 season are now on sale. For more information on Ducks group outings, call 631-940-3825 or visit liducks.com.
This is Long Island Ducks baseball.
Justin Davies at the plate, the winning run at third. Crowd going nuts. Swung on, bouncing ball left side, off the mitt, up third baseman Brad Strauss. Here comes Willie Rodriguez. Justin Davies has done it again. The Ducks are one quack away from the championship.
Jason Johnson makes the catch. He makes the catch, and the Long Island Ducks have swept the Camden River Sharks. They are the 2004 Atlantic League champions.
Going back is Adam Bailey. He settles under it. He makes the catch. Adam Bailey makes the catch. And for a second straight year, the Atlantic League trophy will reside on Long Island. The Ducks are the Atlantic League champions.
Swinging a ground ball, hit toward short, charging in his lines. He fields, throws to first. The comeback is complete. From 2-0 down in the series, the Long Island Ducks have won three in a row at home. And for for the fifth time in franchise history, they will head to the Atlantic League Championship Series.
And now it's time for the Long Island Ducks pregame show.
We are live here at the ballpark at Harbor Yard in Bridgeport, Connecticut. It is time once again for Long Island Ducks baseball. And on this Friday evening, we will play a single admission doubleheader between the crosstown rivals, the Long Island Ducks, and the Bridgeport Bluefish. Well, good afternoon, everybody. My name is Michael Pollock. I'll be bringing you the play-by-play for all of tonight's action. And thank you so much for tuning in here on the Long Island Ducks Broadcast Network, whether you're tuning in on Facebook Live, liducks.com, or our official YouTube channel, youtube.com/ducksbaseball. We, as always, appreciate you joining us for what should be another fun evening of baseball as the Ferry Cup Series continues. Ducks have taken two of the first three in the season series between these two teams. That happened earlier last week at the ballpark at Harbor Yard here in Bridgeport, where the Ducks took the opener and then split a single admission doubleheader that was scheduled between these two teams. That was on Wednesday of that week, May the 24th. But because of a rainout on Thursday, now we will play two games here today at the ballpark at Harbor Yard. Last Thursday, May the 25th, was postponed due to inclement weather. And so here on this Friday, June the 2nd, we'll have two seven-inning games for you to start off this four-game weekend series. Well, yesterday, the Ducks were hoping to end the homestand on a winning note when they faced the Sugarland Skeeters in the rubber game of a three-game series, but it was not meant to be. The Skeeters with a shutout victory, 6-0 over the Ducks, and they took 2 of 3 from Long Island, a disappointing homestand for the Ducks as they finished with a record of just 2-5 against the Barnstormers and the Skeeters. And yesterday, they ended up facing their former pitcher, Bobby Blevins, who got the start for the Sugarland Skeeters, and he twirled 6 scoreless innings, allowing just 5 hits and 2 walks while striking out 6. The Ducks had many chances throughout to get some early runs on the board. They had first and second with nobody out in the first inning, but failed to plate a run in the second inning. They had first and third with 2 out, and in the fourth they had a runner at third with 2 out, but could not plate any runs in that stretch. The bullpen came on in the 7th, 8th, and 9th and held the Ducks hitless, allowing just a walk with 2 outs in the 9th to Andrew Floridis. Meanwhile, on the other side, for the Skeeters, they scored early and often. First, 2 runs in the opening inning against Henry Hirsch, who ended up having to make a spot start for the Ducks. Hirsch was signed and activated by the Ducks yesterday and got thrust right into the spotlight when Dennis O'Grady came down with an illness before the game. He was unavailable to start, so Hirsch began, and after allowing a walk and a 1-out single, he gave up a sacrifice fly to Kevin Ahrens and then an RBI double to Travis Scott that gave the Skeeters a 2-0 lead. Hirsch was able to keep Sugarland off the scoreboard, getting out of jams in the 2nd and 3rd inning, but in the 5th, following back-to-back walks to open the inning, an RBI single by Anthony Giansanti to left field made it a 3-0 score. Bullpen came in the 6th. Zach Treese was the pitcher. He allowed a leadoff solo home runner right to Travis Scott to open up the 6th inning. And then in the 7th inning, following a hit-by-pitch and a walk and then a double steal, all with 1 out in the inning, Kevin Ahrens picked up a 2-out, 2-run single to center field, following up a strikeout from Andy Wilkins that brought in Prince and Giansanti and rounded out the scoring at that point at 6-0. Hirsch ended up going 5 innings for the Ducks. He allowed 3 runs on 5 hits and 4 walks while striking out 5. Kevin Bias said after the game he certainly would have signed up for that, knowing the difficult situation he was put in, having to start right away after signing a contract with the Ducks and reporting to the ballpark from his home in Westchester. And so he ended up getting the loss, the hard luck loss, while Blevins got the win, who improved to 4-1. Patrick Kreider and Amalio Diaz, though, each pitched a scoreless inning in relief, a bright spot for the Ducks on an otherwise disappointing night as the Ducks fell in the homestand finale. And so we enter today with the Ducks at 19-21 through the first 40 games of the season, nearly a third of the way there through the 2017 season. And with 30 games to go here in the first half, the Ducks remain 5.5 games behind the Somerset Patriots in the Liberty Division standings, 3.5 games behind the Bridgeport Bluefish, who they'll face for 4 games this weekend. Bridgeport at 23-18. They're coming off of a 3-game sweep of the New Britain Bees here in Bridgeport earlier this week, and they sit 2 games behind the first-place Patriots. We'll take a break here on the pregame show. When we come back, I'll sit down with Ducks outfielder and bench coach Lou Ford to discuss his return for an 8th season here on Long Island.
Hey, fans. This is manager Kevin Baez, and you're listening to Ducks Baseball on Long Island Ducks Broadcast Network.
Going way back is Joe Holden, and he is looking up, and that one is headed to field 5 at Robert Moses. The waves are gnarly, and the Ducks have tied it at 1.
That was another home run for the Ducks. And Duck fans, what's more fun than a home run that helps the Ducks win a game? How about a homer that helps the community win? Chappie's Funeral Home and the Long Island Ducks have once again teamed up for the Chappie's Home Run Challenge. If the Ducks hit 100 homers this season, Chappie's Funeral Home will donate $5,000 to the Quacker Jack Foundation. So every time a Ducks hitter goes deep this season, watch for the Chappie's Challenge Home Run count on the scoreboard. And if we reach 100, we're all a winner. Chappie's Funeral Home, where caring for others is a family tradition.
Can't get enough of the Long Island Ducks? Well, now you can get even more inside info on your favorite hometown team through Facebook and Twitter. The Ducks are constantly updating fans through social media with scores, transactions, ballpark promotions, and much more. You can even win great prizes. All you'll need to do is make a free account on Facebook and Twitter, and then visit us at Facebook.com/LIDucks and Twitter.com/LIDucks. Think you're Long Island's biggest Ducks fan? Get connected now.
Back here at the ballpark at Harbor Yard, getting ready for tonight's doubleheader between the Long Island Ducks and the Bridgeport Bluefish. I caught up with Lou Ford before the game, the Ducks outfielder and bench coach, who just recently re-signed with the Ducks during the homestand. He is starting his eighth season as a member of the flock, played all three games this week against the Sugar Land Skeeters, so I caught up with him before the game to see how he was feeling after getting back on the baseball field. Lou, back here for another season with the Ducks. You got to play all three games against the Sugar Land Skeeters. How did it feel to get back out there on the field?
It felt great to get back on the field, to just get back in the clubhouse and get back into the swing of things here. And very excited to get to know some of the new players and Billy, the new coach, and looking forward to hopefully getting some wins and trying to continue to win some games here for these guys.
I'm sure it's difficult for every fan to realize, but for you, especially at your age, it takes a little bit of extra time to get prepared for the start of a season after a long year last year, one that features some injuries. But just talk about that process during the off season of getting yourself rested and then getting back ready to go again this year.
Well, everyone's different, but I hate to bring up age, but I've been doing this a long time, and the last 3 years I've played the whole summer here with Long Island, and I go play a whole nother season in the winter, usually Venezuela or Dominican Republic, and after this year doing it, I needed a break, so this year I just took about a month off. I tried to rest and then started trying to get back in shape again. And it took a while, but I want to be ready for the season, ready to play immediately. So, I'm ready now and happy to be here. But, it's a process. I didn't want to, cheat myself or the Ducks by trying to come in if I'm not ready. So.
Did you feel when you took the field in that game against the Skeeters, in the series against the Skeeters, that you were able to see pitches a little bit better, pick up things, get better jumps on the ball, having had that extra rest and now ready to go right from the get-go?
I don't know about that. It's still most guys in baseball go through a little spring training for a couple weeks and, seen them played a couple games and kind of get their feet under them. I'm just jumping in there, but every day I feel, 10 times more comfortable than the previous day. And, it'd take a couple days, but the only way right now to get that feeling of being ready to play every day is just to go out there. So, it's still, I'm still in the process, but it's closer every day.
Ultimately, you have a lot of experience and a lot of wisdom to share with these players. There are guys of very different age ranges among the lineup, but for a team that has been struggling here in the early going to get swinging, what are you hoping to share with the team to hopefully get that offense turned around?
From the first day I got here, just work on an approach with the guys, having a plan when they go up to bat, and pretty basically try to swing at good pitches to hit and take, balls or pitches that are not good to hit, quite simply. But, there's a lot involved in that. And, you know, the guys need to be thinking about that, watching the pitcher, not only during their at-bat, but other guys at bat, see what he's doing. You know, just remind the guys to do that. And, you know, it's early, so for me it's early because I just got here. I know the guys from before, but the new guys, I need to watch them and, you know, see how they're doing. And then, you know, if they need any adjustments, we can work on that.
You're 5.5 games back of Somerset entering this, which means 30 games to go in the first half. And your next 13 games are against Liberty Division opponents, including four here in Bridgeport. How big is this next stretch of games going to be for you guys as a team?
No, it's big. You know, we need to come together as a team here and start winning some games. We need to step it up. And, you know, that winning a couple games in a row here, especially Bridgeport's got a good team. We can win on the road here. It's going to bring the confidence up, and we can keep moving right along. But you know, this is when it starts. We need to get going right now.
Thanks so much for the time, Lou. Best of luck here on the weekend set in Bridgeport.
All right, thanks, Bob.
That is Lou Ford, outfielder and bench coach for the Long Island Ducks. We will take another break on the pregame show. When we come back, we'll look at the pitching matchup here for Game One. Then we'll have the starting lineups for you and the first pitch for today's single admission doubleheader.
Hey fans, this is pitching coach Billy Horn, and you're listening to Ducks Baseball on the Long Island Ducks Broadcast Network.
Oh, I love it. The color of my new Nicolat patio is so vibrant. It's unlike anything I've ever seen.
You're welcome. I'm just going to go finish that Nicolat walkway now.
Make your pavers vivid Nicolat pavers. The best looking, most vibrant pavers with the most 3-color blends in the industry. Featuring Nicolat's exclusive paver shield and color blending technology with color throughout and guaranteed not to fade. Live life in color with Nicolat. Visit Nicolat.com.
Have your birthday at the ballpark this season and celebrate with the flock. Kona Ice birthday party packages with the Long Island Ducks are now available. Each package includes 10 box seats, a commemorative birthday t-shirt and autographed baseball, a pizza and Kona Ice party in the Hebrew National picnic area, and so much more. Best of all, the birthday child will stand on the dugout while the entire crowd sings happy birthday. Reserve your party today by calling the group sales department at 631-940-3825. Kona Ice birthday parties with the Long Island Ducks, a once-in-a-lifetime experience. Back here at the ballpark at Harbor Yard, fans being asked to rise and remove their hats and caps as the Bluefish have taken the field. Now, we turn it over for the playing of our national anthem. We came for baseball and we got a side of a rock concert, an excellent version of our national anthem played on guitar by a young fan here at the ballpark at Harbor Yard, and we are just about ready for baseball here, a single admission doubleheader between the Long Island Ducks and the Bridgeport Bluefish. All right, the pitching matchup for game one. Ducks will go with right-hander Tim Melville, who enters with a 2-3 record and a 3.60 ERA through seven starts on the season. Coming off his worst outing, though, that was against the Barnstormers in game two of the doubleheader Saturday when he allowed six runs, five earned, and 3 2/3 innings. Meanwhile, Corey Reardon, the right-hander, will go for the Bridgeport Bluefish. 2-2 record, 3.94 ERA through seven starts this year. Does not walk many, only six walks in 45 2/3 innings. Meanwhile, he struck out 44, and he earned the win his last time out with seven innings of three-run ball on Sunday against the Somerset Patriots in New Jersey. Starting lineup for today's game one of the doubleheader, it'll be Anthony Vega leading off in left field. Elmer Reyes moves up to the number two spot. He is the second baseman. And in the three spot in right field today is Angelo Sanco. Batting in the four spot, the designated hitter is Lou Ford. Mark Kraus will hit fifth and play first base. Alex Berg is back in the lineup after missing the Sugarland series. He will do the catching and bat sixth. Delta Cleary Jr. back in center field. He hits seventh. The eight hitter is the third baseman, and that's Giovanni Alfonso. And rounding out the order for the Ducks is Dan Lyons. Meanwhile, for Louis Rodriguez's Bridgeport Bluefish, Luis Hernandez leads off. He is the shortstop. Darby Myers bats in the number two spot and plays center field. Jose Hill does the catching and hits third. The cleanup hitter is the former Duck first baseman Sean Burrows. Jonathan Galvez in the five spot. He's the designated hitter. Tony Abreu bats sixth and plays third base. Daniel Fields is the left fielder. He will hit seventh. The eight hitter and second baseman is Jose Cuevas, and rounding out the order for Bridgeport is the right fielder, Osni Guillen. So we are just about ready for baseball on a beautiful Friday evening here in Bridgeport, Connecticut. The weather has been terrific for most of the day. We had a couple little brief rain showers, but not too much to speak of. And we are just about set to go. Corey Reardon winds and fires to the plate. Anthony Vega takes the first pitch outside for ball one. We are underway at about 5:13 p.m. here in Bridgeport, Connecticut. Again, 2 7-inning games here today. 1-0 to Vega, and he swings and misses. Good fastball down in the zone for a strike, one on Vega. Bridgeport is in their alternate jerseys, camouflage on the front and back for the majority of the jersey with navy blue sleeves. The Ducks are in their alternate orange uniforms today. 1-1, breaking ball cut on and foul tipped into the glove of the catcher, Jose Hill, for strike two. And Vega behind at 1-2. He returned to the lineup yesterday after missing a few games with a quad strain, but is back healthy and ready to go. And the 1-2 from Reardon is taken high and outside. Good eye from Vega on the fastball, 2-2. Michael Pollock here bringing you all the action from the ballpark at Harbor Yard. A few fans in attendance here for game one. Get an original start time of 7:12 today. And now the 2-2 pitch is on the outside corner, strike three called. Corey Reardon paints the outside corner on a fastball. First strikeout of the day. And there's one out here in the top of the first inning. The postponed game last Thursday, May the 25th, here in Bridgeport because of inclement weather, forced this game into a doubleheader, a single admission twin bill. And so it starts at 5:12. I'm sure crowd will begin to file in as the games wear on. And the first pitch is taken low and outside for ball one to Elmer Reyes, who is moved up to the number two spot in the order. Kevin Baez juggling with his order a little bit, trying to find the right combination that will get the offense going. The 1-0, Reyes fouls this one back to the screen behind home plate. That looked like an off-speed pitch from Reardon. And so that will even the count at 1-1 on Reyes, who's hitting .290 on the season for the Ducks. No homers and 15 runs batted in. Reardon gets the sign, winds and fires to the plate. And Reyes a swing and a miss as he chases the slider low and outside. And Reardon ahead 1-2. Defense playing straight away here for the righty swinging Reyes. Angelo Sanco waiting in the on-deck circle as he will bat from the left side. Reardon gets the sign. And the 1-2 delivery is swung on and lifted high in the air to right. Moving over towards the line is Osni Guillen. And Guillen will make the catch to retire Reyes for out number two. All right, the defensive lineup for the Bridgeport Bluefish here in game one. Daniel Fields gets the start in left. Darby Myers is the center fielder, and Osni Guillen, as we just mentioned, is around and right. On the infield from left to right, Tony Abreu at third base. Luis Hernandez is the shortstop. Jose Cuevas starts at second base. Sean Burrows is around at first. Jose Hill behind home plate doing the catching for right-hander Corey Reardon, back for his second season as a member of the Bridgeport Bluefish. First pitch to Angelo Sanco was a fastball way upstairs for ball one. Wind is blowing out towards left field. Not a very strong breeze, but definitely blowing a bit from the first base side out to left. Sanko, a rip in a right center field. Guillen racing over into the gap, reaches out. Did he make the catch? He did. Ozdy Guillen got a late jump on it, somehow recovered and just barely caught it to rob Sanko of an extra base hit. So Corey Reardon retires the Ducks in order in the top half of the first inning. We will head to the bottom of inning number one with the Ducks nothing and the Bluefish coming up to bat.
Hey fans, this is pitcher John Brownell, and you're listening to Ducks Baseball on the Long Island Ducks Broadcast Network.
Long Island's Ford Giant is celebrating its 60th year anniversary. Stop by Sayville Ford to check out their state-of-the-art showroom featuring enclosed service drives, luxurious customer lounge, and a larger selection to choose from. Get giant savings on hundreds of new and used vehicles in stock. Sayville Ford's 60th anniversary celebration is going on now. Visit SaylvilleFord.com or download the Sayville Ford app today to learn more about Sayville Ford's 60th anniversary savings. Call 631-589-4800 today.
Bethpage Ballpark is a great place to watch a ball game, so why not do so from some of the best seats in the house? The Ducks are proud to present the brand new Long Island Ducks Beer Garden. Open for all fans on nights when the Smokin' Owl's party deck has not been reserved, the Beer Garden will feature a variety of frosty draft and bottled brews, as well as several food choices. The area has been decked out with bar rail seating and Ducks-branded furniture to provide a comfortable atmosphere for everyone. Be sure to stop by and check out the brand new Long Island Ducks Beer Garden on your next visit to the ballpark. Fans, every walk by a Ducks batter this season is presented by City MD Urgent Care. There are over 15 City MD locations across Long Island offering the comprehensive quality care you need the moment you need it. City MD Urgent Care, need a doctor? Just walk in. So after Corey Reardon retires the side in order in the top of the first, Tim Melville will take the mound for the Ducks here in the bottom of inning number one. And Melville will be facing the top of the order for the Bridgeport Bluefish. It'll be Luis Hernandez, Darby Myers, and Jose Heal to begin for the Bluefish. Again, if you're just joining us, didn't get a chance to tune in for the pregame show. Ducks enter at 19-21 on the season through the first 40 games, almost a third of the way through the season, and 30 games remaining here in the first half. They're 5.5 games behind the Somerset Patriots, 3.5 behind Bridgeport, who sits in second, 2 games behind Somerset. Tim Melville misses up and outside for ball one to the switch hitting shortstop Luis Hernandez. Giovanni Alfonso playing in on the grass at third in case Hernandez tries to lay down the bunt. 1-0. That's skied in the air down the left field line. Slicing foul and down into the empty bleacher seats. Down the line, so the count 1-1. And Bridgeport comes in off of a 3-game sweep of their in-state rivals, the New Britain Bees, here at the ballpark at Harbor Yard earlier this week. Took 3 straight games from them. Melville's 1-1. Swing and a miss. Good high fastball. Got Hernandez to chase through it, and the count goes to 1-2. Ducks, meanwhile, come in after dropping 2 of 3 to the Sugarland Skeeters earlier this week at Bethpage Ballpark in their first meeting with the defending Atlantic League champions. 1-2. Hernandez grounds this one foul to the front of the Bridgeport dugout along the first baseline. 1-2, still the count. Bluefish offense has been very good all season, and they won by counts of 4-1, 8-6, and 5-4 over New Britain. Not necessarily blowouts, but they found ways to win a bunch of close games against the Bees, who, despite struggling, have been a very pesky team. Melville deals a breaking ball that's taken low and outside by Hernandez, who is hitting .268 this year, 2 homers, and 13 runs batted in for the Bluefish, his second season here with Bridgeport. Melville's 2-2 now, swinging a foul straight back to the screen. Hernandez, among this Bluefish order, really one of the most pesky hitters that you will see. I can vividly remember when the Ducks were here at the end of May, just several foul balls during a couple of at-bats, and Hernandez was just such a tough hitter to put away. So now it's a 2-2 count once again. Melville fires to Hernandez, and this is fisted foul. It came right in on the hands of Hernandez, and he fouled it off the backstop on the third base side. The outfield has Hernandez shaded towards left field. Delta Cleary Jr., the center field, way over into the gap in left center and playing very shallow. Anthony Vega also shallow in left. 2-2 fastball is high and outside from Melville. And that runs the count full on Hernandez. Infield, though, straight away. And now the payoff pitch on the way from the right-hander. And Hernandez takes outside, ball four. So a good start for Bridgeport, as Hernandez was able to fight off several tough two-strike pitches and force Melville to miss for ball four. So he allows the walk. Hernandez is on. And the Ducks will certainly be paying attention to him. He is 4-for-4 in the stolen base department this season. So one on, nobody out here is the righty swinging Darby Myers, the center fielder and two hitter for Bridgeport. Melville comes set, working out of the stretch now, and his first pitch is skied in the air to center. Barely having to move on it is Delta Cleary Jr. He takes a couple steps in and makes the catch for the first out. And Myers is not really much for sacrifice bunting. Even though he was hitting in the nine spot earlier this year, he has no sacrifice bunt on the season. Luis Rodriguez, who normally is a small ball manager, was wondering if he was going to try and lay down a bunt there to move the runner into scoring position for Jose Heal. That did not happen. But you've got a dangerous 3-4 in the order here with Jose Heal, who is hitting 326, and then Sean Burrows in the cleanup spot at 362. Bridgeport, when the Ducks were last here, had Alberto Callaspo in that three spot of the order. He was hitting 344 through the first 34 games of the season, but had his contract purchased in between the Ducks' visits here, so the Ducks no longer have to deal with the former major leaguer. Here's Jose Heal from the right side. Tim Melville misses with a fastball outside. And the count 1-0 on Heal. Mentioned his 326 average. He's got one home run and 12 runs batted in on the season. He was typically hitting the five spot when the Ducks were here last time. Now up in Callaspo's three spot. Hernandez leads at first, and the 1-0 breaking ball swung on and missed. Good slider that time from Melville down in the zone. And that will even up the count at 1-1 on Heal. Infield and outfield both straight away here for the catcher. The second baseman, Ray, is shaded a little bit towards the middle in case Hernandez takes off. 1-1 pitch. Heal swings, pops this one in the air to right center. Angelo Sanko racing in, still coming on in right, and he's going to make the catch. Now, Sanko got a little bit of a late break on that and had to race in quickly to get to it. But Jose Heal is retired for out number two. Phelan Lentini not getting the start in right field as he is on the inactive list away from the team for a family function, but he should be back, I believe, by the end of the weekend, if my memory serves correct. So there's the second out. So as we mentioned, Sanko is in right field today. Delta Cleary Jr. back at center field after serving as the DH yesterday. And in left field is Anthony Vega. On the infield from left to right, Giovanni Alfonso at third, Dan Lyons at short. Elmer Reyes, the second baseman, Mark Krause at first. Alex Berg back behind home plate doing the catching for the right-hander Tim Melville. Here's Sean Burrows from the left side. He takes the first pitch fastball on the outside corner for strike one. Burrows has been one of the best hitters in the Atlantic League, obviously since he's come into the league, but especially this year. He's hitting 362 with two homers and 16 runs batted in. Here is the 0-1 from Melville. Swinging a fly ball deep in the air to left. That chases Vega back into the corner and left, and Vega will make the catch on the warning track. Sean Burrows gave it a ride the opposite way, but not deep enough, and that will retire the side here in the opening inning. Good job by Melville following the leadoff walk. No runs, no hits, one left on base. We played one here in Bridgeport, no score between the Ducks and the Bluefish.
Hey fans, this is shortstop Dan Lyons, and you're listening to Ducks Baseball on the Long Island Ducks Broadcast Network.
PSEG Long Island is making things work for you with over 10 energy efficiency programs that can help you save on your monthly electric bill. From our free online energy analyzer and in-home energy assessments to rebates on energy-efficient air conditioning, even discounts on LED light bulbs. Helping you save on electricity is our job. What to do with your savings?
Flight 85 now boarding for the magic of Orlando.
Is entirely up to you. Visit PSEGLINY.com/save money. Just one more way PSEG Long Island is making things work for you.
Take your group out to the ball game this season and enjoy all the fun of Ducks baseball at discounted prices with the picnic area, luxury suites, the Smokin' Owls party deck, and so much more. Bringing your group to the game will be an unforgettable experience. The Ducks even offer opportunities to sing the national anthem, serve as the Ridgewood Savings Bank color guard, be the Nickelock Dream Team, put on a pregame performance, or shag fly balls during Ducks batting practice. To book your outing today, call 631-940-3825 and ask for the group sales department. Long Island Ducks Baseball. Good times every time.
As we move to the second inning here in Game 1 of today's doubleheader, time for the Ducks Health Report, and that's brought to you by Island Shore Physical Therapy, the official therapist of the Long Island Ducks. Now, Dennis O'Grady, who last night was supposed to start for Long Island, ended up coming down with an illness before the game, had to get scratched. That's why Henry Hirsch started the final game of the series against the Sugarland Skeeters. Much better report on O'Grady today. First pitch here to Lou Ford. And that's taken on the inside corner for strike one. Feeling much better. I saw him before the game. He certainly looked and felt better. So the hope is that he will be backing up Rafael Perez, who will start for the Ducks in game two later this evening. 1-0. Breaking ball is taken low. 1-1. And now the count is 1-1. It was an 0-1 pitch first. Now 1-1 on Ford, who's 3 for his first 12 of the season. Pitch on the way. Ford lines this one foul back behind the plate. So that is good news on O'Grady. And, of course, Perez, who had been out due to the groin strain, has missed his last two starts. He will start tonight in game two of the doubleheader. So that was also good news for the Ducks. Pitch on the way from Reardon. And Ford a half swing at a ball down and in, and that is strike three. So Lou Ford goes down swinging for the first out of the inning. And that will bring up Mark Krause to the plate. Second strikeout for Reardon. Out on the disabled list for the Ducks, David Ardsma, the right-handed closer for Long Island. He is dealing with a pectoral injury. And Tyler Wilson, who is also out on the disabled list. No timetable on the return for either of those two just yet. So here's the lefty swinging Mark Krause to the plate. Five-hitter and first baseman for Long Island. First pitch from Reardon. Krause takes a fastball that misses outside for ball one. Umpires for this game calling balls and strikes behind home plate is Matt Hensel. John Garasso is over at first base and Matthew Kane around at third. 1-0 from Reardon. Krause swings, lifts a fly ball in the air to left towards the line. Long run over for Daniel Field, still chasing over. And on the run, he makes the catch to retire Krause for the second out of the second inning. Well, Reardon has been doing a good job this season for Bridgeport. He is 2-2 and has a 3.94 ERA through his first seven starts. And when you look at his numbers, most notably, it is that he barely walks anybody and strikes out a lot. In the first seven starts that he has made this season, he has walked just six batters. And three of those six came in his second start, April 26th, down in Sugarland. So in his other six starts, he has walked a combined three batters. First pitch here to Alex Berg is a fastball that misses low for ball one. Last time out, didn't walk anybody in seven innings, allowed three runs all earned on six hits, and struck out five in a 4-3 win against the Patriots in Bridgewater, New Jersey. Berg takes low for ball two. That was this past Sunday, a 4-3 win for the Bluefish over the Patriots. And it was Reardon's first win since that April 26th start down in Texas. Two out of Berg, rocked into left center field. On the run back is Darby Myers. He's going to catch up to this one and make the grab. A hard hit baseball off the bat of Alex Berg, but it results in a line out to center, and it's six up and six down for Bluefish right-hander Corey Reardon. So we head to the bottom of the second here in Bridgeport, still no score.
Hey fans, this is outfielder Delta Cleary Jr., and you're listening to Ducks Baseball on the Long Island Ducks Broadcast Network.
Hey, Ducks fans, the official hotel of the Long Island Ducks is the Radisson Hotel Hop Hog Long Island. It's centrally located on the north shore of Long Island and offers a home away from home for both business and leisure guests. The Radisson Hotel Hop Hog Long Island features an indoor pool, 24-hour business center, a fitness center, and complimentary Wi-Fi in all guest rooms. Enjoy the contemporary American cuisine at the Fountain Grill restaurant or grab a quick bite to eat at Cafe Pronto. And best of all, it's only minutes away from Bethpage Ballpark. The Radisson Hotel Hop Hog Long Island, the official hotel of the Long Island Ducks. Call 631-231-1100 today. That's 631-231-1100.
Baseball fans, the Long Island Ducks mobile app has officially arrived. Powered by Clear Vision Apps, it's your one-stop shop for all things Ducks baseball. Buy tickets straight from your mobile device. Receive game status updates with push notifications. Check out up-to-the-minute news and scores and interact with the Ducks on social media. Best of all, it's free. Download the Ducks mobile app today by visiting the App Store on your Apple-powered device or Google Play on your Android-powered device. The Long Island Ducks mobile app, with you wherever you flock to. Well, fans, there's no better time than right now to sign up the young Ducks fan in your life for the Bethpage Federal Credit Union Long Island Ducks Kids Club. Children 14 and under will receive exciting gifts, discounts on merchandise, and unique experiences that only come with being a member. Sign up today by visiting www.liducks.com or during normal business hours, you can call 631-940-3825. Michael Pollock here with you at the ballpark at Harbor Yard. We go to the bottom of the second inning. No score between the Ducks and the Bluefish. And Tim Melville back to the mound to face 5, 6, and 7 in the Bluefish order. Galvez, Abreu, and Fields. Again, this is the ninth edition of the Ferry Cup Series this year. Ducks have taken 5 of the first 8 cups after it was brought into play in 2009. First pitch is taken low and inside for ball one. Ducks won the Ferry Cup last year by taking 12 of the 20 meetings between the two teams during the regular season. So trying to win the cup for a second straight year are the Ducks. They're off to a 2-1 start this season. 1-0. That slider just misses a little bit high above the belt. 2-0 on Galvez, who is hitting .266 this year. He has clubbed 7 home runs and has driven in 23. The 2-0. That fastball is a little bit low this time. So now 3-0 the count on Galvez. The wind and the offering, and that's high ball four. So in back-to-back innings, Tim Melville has walked the leadoff hitter. And Melville, who has walked 14 and 35 innings coming into tonight, has walked back-to-back hitters, or walked back-to-back leadoff hitters in the ballgame. Obviously not how you want to start off an inning, but Melville was able to recover after it last inning and got 3 straight flyouts to center, right, and left in that order. Here is the switch hitting Tony Abreu, third baseman and 6 hitter for Bridgeport. Melville from the stretch in the first pitch. There's a fastball strike right over the outside corner. Nothing and one on Abreu, a .236 hitter this year. He's got 3 home runs and 19 runs batted in. Melville gets the sign and comes set. Galvez leads at first. And the 0-1. Abreu skies one in the air to left. Hit pretty well, but Vega is right there. And Vega will make the catch for out number one. Ball looks like it's jumping off the mat pretty good out to left, but the wind, which is now blowing more towards center field, not really helping matters for the hitters in this game. So one away. And that is going to bring up the left fielder, Daniel Fields. Fields a lefty hitter, and he will bat in the 7th spot of the order for Bridgeport. Well, Melville is certainly looking to bounce back. Melville in the rotation did not have a good start his last time out. That was against the Barnstormers last Saturday. This is fisted out in a shallow left. Long run in for Anthony Vega. He's not going to get it. It drops in for a base hit. Stopping at second base is Galvez. A little bloop single the other way for Fields, the first hit of the game for either side. So Bridgeport with runners at first and second now, one away. and that'll bring Jose Cuevas to the plate. In game two of the doubleheader last Saturday at Bethpage Ballpark, Melville allowed 6 runs, 5 of which were earned over 3 2/3 innings. Surrendered 7 hits. He only walked 1 batter, though, and struck out 7. But just did not seem to have that pinpoint command that he had in his previous 2 starts. The Barnstormers, who have a very good offense, certainly took advantage. So here's Jose Cuevas from the right side. And the first pitch to him is a slider taken low and outside for ball one. Cuevas, like Abreu, also hitting .236 on the year. He has 1 home run, 15 runs batted in. And Melville looking to get the ground ball here to try and turn 2. Elmer Reyes, the second baseman, is shaded towards the middle, so a big hole on the right side of the infield. Lyons and Alfonso playing in their normal positions. And the 1-0 is hit back towards the middle. Reyes can't get it. It's in a center field, a base hit. Around third is Galvez. He's going to come in to score. The throw goes into the shortstop, Lyons. It gets past him, though. An RBI single for Jose Cuevas, and it is a 1-0 lead for the Bluefish. Well, Elmer Reyes looked like he was playing right in the right spot towards the middle behind second base, but it looked like he got a poor read on that ground ball. And I don't know if Melville blocked him on it when it was hit towards the middle or what, but Reyes was late to react, and by the time he could, it was hit too quickly that he could not grab it. So Cuevas with the RBI single. That is his 16th run batted in of the year. The leadoff walk comes back to bite Melville, and still first and second with one out. That'll bring Osni Guillen to the plate. Guillen will bat from the left side. And Melville's first pitch is a fastball taken inside and low, ball one. Guillen at .284 on the year with a home run and 11 runs batted in. This time it's Lyons slightly shaded towards the middle at short. Reyes in his normal spot at second base. And Kraus near the line at first behind the runner. 1-0. Almost bunted at by Guillen. He ends up taking a breaking ball strike at the knees on the outside corner. Melville has struck out 15 batters and walked just 3 in his past 2 outings. He took an 11-inning scoreless streak into his last outing before getting roughed up by the Barnstormers, so he is looking to get back to his winning ways. But behind the eight ball here early are the Ducks. 1-1, skied foul down the left field line, a line drive off the bat of Guillen. Now the count 1-2. Kevin Baez has said it's tough because for the most part it is up to the next day's starting pitcher who sets the tone, and obviously that's important. But the offense right now for the Ducks, just 1 run in their last 2 games. They certainly have to improve to get the Ducks back on the winning track. Here comes a 1-ball, 2-strike pitch to Guillen. Melville deals, and Guillen lifts one in the air to center, hit well. Back goes Cleary Jr., straightaway center, now towards left center, and on the warning track he's going to make the catch. Both runners tagging up, and the throw is not going to be in time. So a fly out to the center fielder, Osni Guillen, is retired for the second out. But both runners on the deep fly ball move up. So Fields goes to third, Cuevas to second. And with 2 outs, back to the top of the order for Luis Hernandez. Now that ball certainly took off and carried much better than the balls hit out to left field have in this game. Cleary Jr. did well to get it, but the runners paid attention. They were able to move up, and now 2 in scoring position with 2 away. And here is Hernandez, who drew a walk to open up the bottom of the first. Melville gets the sign from Bergen, comes set. His first pitch to Hernandez is a breaking ball that kicks off the foot of Alex Bergen. Ricochets to the third base out of home plate. Into score from third is going to be Fields. Cuevas moves to third, and it's a 2-0 lead for Bridgeport. Looked like a little bit of a cross up there, as it's kind of a breaking ball that came down and away. I don't know if that hit off the foot or the shin pad of Alex Berg, but either way, a 2-out run scores. And that makes it a 2-run advantage for the Bluefish. We'll see if it's a pass ball or a wild pitch. Either way, they count 1-0 on Hernandez, the switch hitting shortstop. Melville comes set, and the 1-0. Hernandez flies one in the air to left field, hit well. Back goes Vega. He's got plenty of room, though, and he'll make the catch to end the inning. But the Bluefish strike first in this game. They pick up 2 runs here in the second inning. on a couple of hits, a walk, no errors in the inning, and one runner left on base. After two here in Bridgeport, it is the Bluefish 2 and the Ducks nothing.
Hey fans, this is outfielder Angelo Sanco, and you're listening to Ducks Baseball on the Long Island Ducks Broadcast Network.
Going way back is Joe Holden, and he is looking up, and that one is headed to field 5 at Robert Moses. The waves are gnarly, and the Ducks have tied it at 1.
That was another home run for the Ducks. And Duck fans, what's more fun than a home run that helps the Ducks win a game? How about a homer that helps the community win? Chappie's Funeral Home and the Long Island Ducks have once again teamed up for the Chappie's Home Run Challenge. If the Ducks hit 100 homers this season, Chappie's Funeral Home will donate $5,000 to the Quacker Jack Foundation. So every time a Ducks hitter goes deep this season, watch for the Chappie's Challenge home run count on the scoreboard. And if we reach 100, we're all a winner. Chappie's Funeral Home, where caring for others is a family tradition.
Can't get enough of the Long Island Ducks? Well, now you can get even more inside info on your favorite hometown team through Facebook and Twitter. The Ducks are constantly updating fans through social media with scores, transactions, ballpark promotions, and much more. You can even win great prizes. All you'll need to do is make a free account on Facebook and Twitter, and then visit us at Facebook.com/LIDucks and Twitter.com/LIDucks. Think you're Long Island's biggest Ducks fan? Get connected now.
New York Sports Day is one of the largest independent New York sports sources out there for coverage of the Long Island Ducks, Mets, Yankees, Major and Minor League Baseball, football, basketball, hockey, and soccer. Visit www.nysportsday.com. New York Sports Day, your independent Gotham sports news source. So the Ducks behind 2-0 as we move to the third. Corey Reardon has retired the first six in order, and it'll be Cleary Jr., Alfonso, and Lyons for the flock in the third inning. First pitch from Reardon. Cleary Jr. takes a fastball. That's on the inside corner for strike one. Cleary Jr. hitting .228 on the year. A home run and 13 runs batted in. And the 0-1 pitch is a breaking ball that just misses below the knees. To even things up at 1-1. First game this season that Cleary Jr. did not play in center field last night, when Cleary Jr. got the half day as the designated hitter and Lou Ford got the start in center. Now 1-1, breaking ball, line down the left field line. That's going to slice foul, though, into the picnic area, out of play. And Cleary Jr. now behind at 1-2. Cleary Jr. back in center field, though, today is for the half day as the designated hitter. At least that's the way it goes here in game one. And the 1-2 is down and in. Good eye taken by Cleary Jr. 2 balls, 2 strikes, the Ducks center fielder. He'll be fouled again by Giovanni Alfonso and Dan Lyons. 2-2 from Reardon. Lifted in the air again down the left field line, and once again that goes foul. Some high puffy clouds overhead, but peaks of blue sky throughout. And hopefully the threat of rain has passed. Again, a couple of little showers earlier this afternoon, but nothing to prevent this game from happening. Another 2-2 is hit back towards the middle and into center field. There's a base hit. So the Ducks have their first hit of this game as Cleary Jr. singles to center. And the leadoff man is on here in inning number 3. Well, the Ducks will see if they use Cleary Jr.'s speed. He's 12 for 14 in the stolen base department this year. And with Phelan Lentini not on the active roster currently, Cleary Jr. sports the best speed of anybody on this lineup. When you lose Lentini, you lose a ton of speed. So we'll see what they do here. Here's Giovanni Alfonso from the right side. And the first pitch to him is a fastball taken down and in for ball one. Alfonso, a .306 hitter for the Ducks this season. No home runs, 9 RBIs. He has been the bright spot of the Ducks' offense here in the early going, at least in terms of getting on base on a consistent basis. And had his first triple of the season and second in his career yesterday. 1-0, and Alfonso lifts a fly ball to right. Osni Guillen moving in, and towards the line, he'll make the catch to retire Alfonso. One away for the Ducks now here in the top of inning number 3. Lights are not on here at the ballpark at Harbor Yard. Again, a light crowd on hand at this current moment in time. I'm sure we will see more fans start to fill the ballpark as we get closer to 7 o'clock. Again, this was originally a 7:12 start before the rainout last Thursday in Bridgeport forced this into a doubleheader. And some fans may not have known about that, so we'll see what happens. Here's Dan Lyons from the right side, and he takes the first pitch low. Good job by Heel on the backhand to keep it at home plate. They count 1-0. Lyons comes into the game at 224 on the season for the Ducks. No home runs and 7 runs batted in. Shortstop and 9 hitter for Long Island. 7th season with the Ducks. A throw over to first chases Cleary Jr. back. Sean Burroughs, his former teammate, holding him on there at first. The two seem to be exchanging some friendly words over there. Reardon ready to go, and is 1-0 to Lyons. That fastball is taken inside under the hands. So 2 balls and no strikes on the Ducks shortstop. Long Island trying to bounce back after allowing 2 in the second. And try and cut into the deficit or even the score. Reardon working out of the stretch. 2-0 delivery. Lyons takes all the way. That fastball misses the outside corner. Reardon looked like he thought he had strike one, but Lyons now ahead 3-0, and another out of the zone would put the tying runs on for Anthony Vega. Heel gives the sign to Reardon. Here's the delivery. Cleary Jr. goes. Pitch is taken for a strike, and the throw to second base is in. No, not in time. Cleary Jr.'s off the bag. He doesn't realize it, and just somehow gets back. That was almost disaster for the Ducks, and now Luis Rodriguez is going to come out and have a discussion with the third base umpire who made that call. That was Matthew Kane. Shocked to see Cleary Jr. going there on a 3-0 pitch. And it looked like it was the shortstop Hernandez who came in and applied the tag. And Cleary Jr. thought he was out. He had gotten up and started to take a couple steps back towards the dugout. When the second baseman, Jose Cuevas, was backing up, he saw Cleary Jr. walking off after the safe call. And then Cleary Jr. quickly had to scramble back to second base and got back just ahead of the tag. That would have been an awful way to get out at second base if you're Cleary Jr. But he does get the stolen base. It is his 13th of the season. The discussion between Kane and Rodriguez is over. And now here is Lyons with a 3-ball, 1-strike count. Reardon looks back to second, deals to the plate. Lyons takes down and away, 4. So Dan Lyons draws the 1-out walk. That is the first base on balls drawn by the Ducks in this game, and it's brought to you by CityMD Urgent Care. There are over 15 CityMD locations across Long Island. Need a doctor, just walk in. So after the stolen base by Cleary Jr. on the 3-0 pitch and a walk to Lyons, the Ducks set up with first and second, only 1 out. And here is the lefty swinging Anthony Vega up to home plate. Reardon gets the sign, looks back to second. Deals to the plate. Vega takes a fastball that hits the outside corner for strike one. Vega, a strikeout victim his first time up, now 7 for his first 29 here this season with the Ducks. Now the 0-1, swing and a miss, good breaking ball. Vega was a bit out in front, so now he's behind nothing and 2. Vega missed almost a month to begin the season as he was finishing up his collegiate year. Went to school, back to school in the offseason, and now back here with the Ducks. Trying to drive in at least one run here with the Ducks trailing by 2. Here's the 0-2 pitch. Reardon fires. Vega swing and a miss. Strike 3. He goes down on strikes for the second time tonight. Looked like he foul tipped that into the glove of the catcher. So there is the second out and strikeout number 3 for Reardon. And with 2 away, that's going to leave it up to Elmer Reyes. Well, one thing that killed the Ducks last night was runners left on. They left 8 men on base and 7 in the first 5 innings. After falling behind 2-0 early, they were never able to get back into the game, and the Skeeters put the game away late. Here's Reyes from the right side. First pitch breaking ball is taken upstairs, 1-0. Reyes with a fly out to right his first time up. Ducks looking for a base hit here from their second baseman, who has been slumping a little bit of late. Now the 0-1. And Reyes a swing and a foul tip at home plate. Foul it down into the dirt. And the count goes 1-1. So Reardon trying to work around the single and the walk. Reyes this year hitting just 154 with runners in scoring position and two men out. Trying to buck that trend here. The 0-2. Swing and a miss. Strike three. Or excuse me, the count was 1-1. That's my mistake. A swing and a miss. And now the count goes to 1-2. This broadcaster paid too much attention to the line score there, which showed an 0-2 count, but the count was 1-1, so that is my fault. The count was 1-1, now 1-2 on Reyes. And outside called as Reardon steps off. Cleary Jr. leads at second, Lyons at first with two down, the 1-2 to Reyes, and he swings and lines this one into right center field. That's going to get down for a base hit. Cleary Jr. rounds third. He'll score easily. Ball gets by Darby Myers. Lyons now racing around third. He's going to come in and score. And just like that, on the RBI single and the error, the Ducks have tied the ball game up at two apiece. So a big break there for Long Island as Reyes, with a count of 1-2, is able to dunk a single in a right center field. Darby Myers can't come up with it. And once the ball got by him, Dan Lyons was off to the races. He's able to score all the way from first on the play. Again, I think that will be a single and an error. Now Reyes is at second as the go-ahead run. And up to the plate will step Angelo Sanko, the right fielder and three-hitter. Reardon looks back to second base. And the first pitch to Sanko, hit high in the air to center. Got under it off the end of the bat. Myers drifts in. And Myers will make the catch to put an end to this inning. But not before the Ducks tie the game. They get two runs on two hits and error, and they leave one on base. We have played 2.5 innings here in Bridgeport. And the Ducks and the Bluefish are now tied up at two apiece.
Hey fans, this is outfielder Phelan Lentini, and you're listening to Ducks Baseball on the Long Island Ducks Broadcast Network.
Oh, I love it. The color of my new Nicolat patio is so vibrant. It's unlike anything I've ever seen.
You're welcome. I'm just going to go finish that Nicolat walkway now.
Make your pavers vivid Nicolat pavers. The best looking, most vibrant pavers with the most three color blends in the industry. Featuring Nicolat's exclusive paver shield and color blending technology with color throughout and guaranteed not to fade. Live life in color with Nicolat. Visit Nicolat.com.
Have your birthday at the ballpark this season and celebrate with the flock. Kona Ice birthday party packages with the Long Island Ducks are now available. Each package includes 10 box seats, a commemorative birthday t-shirt and autographed baseball, a pizza and Kona Ice party in the Hebrew National picnic area, and so much more. Best of all, the birthday child will stand on the dugout while the entire crowd sings happy birthday. Reserve your party today by calling the group sales department at 631-940-3825. Kona Ice birthday parties with the Long Island Ducks, a once-in-a-lifetime experience. Well, we go to the bottom of the third inning here in Bridgeport. Ducks and the Bluefish now tied up at two apiece. Had to wait for the official scoring to come in, but it is official now. Elmer Reyes gets his 16th RBI of the season on the base hit to center. That scores Delta Cleary Jr. That made it a 2-1 game. And on the same play, Darby Myers, the center fielder, was unable to handle the ground ball up the middle in center field, so he makes an error that scores Lyons, who was running on the play. And so he comes home on the E8 for Myers, his second error of the year. Reyes ended up going to second and got stranded there. So now a 2-2 game, Melville back to the mound, and he will face Darby Myers to begin this third inning. First pitch to him is a fastball taken high and inside for ball one. So one run earned, 1-1 unearned in that third inning. Just like Melville, two runs, one of them earned, one unearned because of a pass ball. 1-0, that's fouled off into the dirt at home plate. Looked like that shook up home plate umpire Matt Hensel a little bit. The count out, one ball and one strike. Good job by the Ducks to come back right away after falling behind and tie the game. Elmer Reyes comes up with a clutch two-out, two-strike hit. And the Ducks take advantage of the error by Myers as well to score the tying run. Melville's 1-1. Myers takes a fastball that misses low and outside. Two balls, one strike on Myers, who flew out to center field his first time up. That was back in the opening inning. Melville winds the 2-1. Myers takes that, misses downstairs, and Melville now one more out of the strike zone away from walking the leadoff hitter for a third straight inning. Obviously not something you want to do. Here comes Melville's 3-1, and this is fouled back to the screen for strike two. So it does get the count full on Darby Myers. Myers last night, as a train rolls on by, Myers last night was 0 for 2 in the game against the New Britain Bees. Did reach on an error and drew a pair of walks. Payoff pitch from Melville, and Myers takes slow and outside, ball four. So make it three straight innings for the Ducks right-hander in which he walks the leadoff hitter. Very bizarre to see, but that is the way it has gone for Melville thus far in this game. So the leadoff man is on. Leadoff hitters this year coming into today, a 276 average against Melville, 8 for 29. Myers is on with his good speed, and that will bring to the plate Jose Heel, the catcher and three hitter. It worked for Melville in the first inning. It did not work for him, though, in inning number two. First pitch on the way to Jose Heel, and that's taken on the inside corner for strike one. Myers, 6 stolen bases on the season. He has been caught twice, so 6 of 8. Has a 75% success rate. Middle infielders at double play depth. Ray is shaded towards the middle at second. And the 0-1, squaring to bunt, and bunt to get foul behind the plate was Heel. Kind of a delayed takeoff by Myers, and then Heel tried to lay down the bunt and surprise the infield. Now the count nothing and two. This is the first ever start for Melville against the Bridgeport Bluefish. Has not faced them this season. It also breaks up a string of 6 straight starts at home for Melville. He has not started on the road since April the 23rd, which was down in Southern Maryland when he pitched game 2 of a doubleheader. His 6 starts since have all come at Bethpage Ballpark. 0-2. It's hit on the ground to the right side and through a base hit for Heel. Myers goes to second. He'll stop right there as Sanko fires it back in. So a walk and a single, and the Bluefish are in business here in the third inning. Looked like Heel got jammed on that pitch, but he was able to fight it off enough and hit it towards the right side where there was a big hole. Reyes shaded towards the middle. Kraus was close to the line at first base, holding on the runner, and could not get over in time. And now you've got one of the best hitters in the league thus far this year at the plate in Sean Burrows, with a chance to give the Bluefish the lead back. So here is Burrows from the left side. First pitch on the way from Melville. Kicks and fires. Burrows squares to bunt, and he ends up taking a fastball down and in. And the count 1-0. Surprising to see Burrows trying to bunt. He has laid down one this year. But he is the league's leading hitter coming into the game at 362. Hit a ball deep to left field his first time up, but it was caught by Anthony Vega in the left field corner. See if he tries to square again. The 1-0. Melville deals. Burrows does square and bunts right through it for strike one. So surprising. Got a guy who's hitting 362 at the plate in a 2-2 game, bottom of the third inning. I get that it's a 7-inning game, but do you really want to take the bat out of Sean Burrows' hands? It looks like Luis Rodriguez wants to play small ball here in this third inning. So one ball, one strike count on Burrows. Myers leads at second and Heel at first. Alfonso playing behind the grass at third base, just behind it. The 1-1, Burrows squares again, pops the bunt foul. right into the front row to the right of the Ducks dugout on the third base side. And now with two strikes on Burrows, does Rodriguez take the sign off? Yesterday, Burrows 0 for 3 with a walk. Melville can't leave anything out over the plate here. I'm sure with two strikes, Burrows will be ready to swing away unless the bunt sign is back on again. Here's the 1-2 delivery. Kicks and fires. Burrows does not square and ends up taking downstairs. Good block at home plate by Alex Berg. Now leaving the count at 2-2. In that only road start this year, Melville pitched four innings, typical for his first start of the year. He allowed two runs on three hits, walked one and struck out one. The Ducks rallied late and won the game 3-2 down in Waldorf, Maryland. Salvaged a split of the doubleheader and a split of that four-game series to begin the season. 2-2 from Melville. And Burrows hits a drive in the air to right. That's deep. Sanko racing back. It's going to be over his head, and it goes to the wall. Myers will round third. He'll come in to score. Also rounding third is Heel. The relay throw in is not going to be in time. It's a two-run double for Sean Burrows, and the Bluefish have their two-run advantage back at 4-2. That's why I was saying I was so surprised to see Luis Rodriguez asking Burrows to try and sacrifice himself and move the runners over, because he can do just that. And even though Melville got to two strikes, was not able to retire him for Burrows, it is his eighth double of the year, RBIs 17 and 18. And after the Ducks get the two-out hit to tie the game in the third, Bluefish get it right back. And somehow, according to the scoreboard, they got four runs on that one play. And it says that Bridgeport is leading 6-2, when in reality, it is just 4-2. Now they've got it corrected. Here's Jonathan Galvez to the plate. From the right side, first pitch from Melville is at the knees for a strike. And the count nothing and one. Myers scores his 15th run of the season, and Heel his 17th. A walk, a single, and a double, and not the start Melville was looking for here in the third. Right-hander comes set, and the 0-1. That breaking ball is taken on the inside corner for a strike. And Galvez, who drew a walk to begin the second, is now behind, and nothing in two. O-2 delivery from Melville, and he misses down and away for ball one. Galvez yesterday was 1-for-3 in the game against New Britain, drew a walk, scored a run. Again, Bridgeport won that game last night to complete a sweep of their in-state rivals, the New Britain Bees. 1-2 pitch, Galvez a swing and a foul tip into the glove of Alex Berg, that is strike three. So Galvez goes down swinging, first strike out of the night for Tim Melville. And one away here in inning number three. By the way, fans, when Angelo Sanko flew out to center field for the final out of the top of the third inning, that was the 15th out of today's game. Did you know that a 15-minute phone call to Geico could save you 15% or more on your car insurance? Get a free quote today, call 1-800-947-AUTO. 1-800-947-AUTO, or visit geico.com. Tony Abreu takes a first pitch fastball inside, and the count 1-0. Abreu a fly out to left field in his first at bat of the night. That was back in the second inning. One oh delivery, and Abreu takes again. This one misses low and outside. And the count goes to two balls and no strikes. So back-to-back shaky starts here for Tim Melville. After going 11 straight innings without giving up a run, he allowed six runs his last time out and already has given up four in this game. 2-0 pitch. Abreu a swing and a foul tip. No, he missed it. And the ball gets away from Alex Berg, so that is going to allow Sean Burrows to scamper to third base. I thought he had foul tipped it, but no argument from Alex Berg, so he must have just missed it, and Berg could not come up with the baseball. So that gives Burrows third base. That's big, because now a fly ball here from Abreu could score a run and make this a three-run ball game. They rule it a wild pitch on Tim Melville. Infield in now. The 2-1 is slashed into left field. There's a base hit for Tony Abreu. Burroughs trots in from third with a run. An RBI single for Tony Abreu, and the Bluefish have their biggest lead of the game. It's 5-2. So give Abreu the RBI on the base hit. For Abreu, that is RBI number 20 on the season. Burroughs scores his 21st run at the third hit of the inning against Melville. No visit to the mound, though, from Billy Horn, the pitching coach for the Ducks. So one on, one out, and now the lefty swinging Daniel Fields, the sixth man to come to the plate in this inning. Melville comes at his first pitch, and that breaking ball misses the outside corner. One ball and no strikes. Fields with a single back in the second inning. That was the first hit of the game for Bridgeport. Eventually scored on a pass ball against Alex Berg, the catcher. Here comes the 1-0. And that's a fastball taken right at the knees for a strike. That'll even the count at 1-1. Fields last played on Tuesday night against the New Britain Bees. He was 2-for-3 in that game with a run scored. Also was hit by a pitch in that one. Did not play yesterday and did not play on Wednesday night. The 1-1. Fouled over the screen off to the third base side of home plate. Back into the seats. And the count goes to 1-2. Well, the Bridgeport Bluefish this year have certainly thrived on their offense. That has been their go-to. They come into this game as the second-ranked team in the Atlantic League in batting average at 281. Barnstormers 10 points higher at 291 as Fields grounds this one foul. Bridgeport's pitching staff has certainly improved. They got off to a slow start, but they're now third in the league coming into this game, right behind the Ducks with an ERA of 4.00. Ducks at 3.83. Somerset leading the way at 3.65. It's the Bluefish defense that has prevented them from having an even better record. They're last in the league with the most errors at 47 and the lowest fielding percentage at 967. 1-2. That breaking ball misses outside from Melville. And the count goes even at 2 balls and 2 strikes. Melville throwing a lot of pitches here in this game early. Very much like what we saw last time. He is already up at about 58 pitches for this game as we play here in the third inning. 2-2 pitch. Swing and a miss. Strike three. He's able to beat Fields on the fastball. So Melville with 2 strikeouts in this third inning. He picks up his second strikeout of the game. Now with 2 outs, that will leave it up to the second baseman, Jose Cuevas.
Second baseman, Jose Cuevas.
Meanwhile, the Ducks starting pitching, which was superb when they entered the series the last time these two teams played, started to fall off a little bit. First pitch is taken high and inside for ball one, and it really all started with game two of that doubleheader here. Matt Larkins took the loss in game one, but he pitched pretty well. He allowed just 2 runs in 5 innings. Gave the Ducks a chance, but the Ducks were shut out by Chris Rurick that day. 1-0 to Cuevas, and he'll take a breaking ball high and inside, ball two. But Jack Snodgrass started that second game for Long Island, lasted just 2 innings in his first start of the year, got roughed up. Keith Couch lasted just an inning and a third on that Friday night against the Barnstormers. And for the most part, since that start by Snodgrass, the Ducks starting pitching just has not been as dominant as it was. The 1-0, skied high in the air, foul, first base side. Berg giving it a chase. This will go well back into the seats, though. About 7 rows back, and now about 6 kids chasing after the baseball. So 2-1 are now on Cuevas, who picked up an RBI single to center field in the second inning, his 16th run batted into the year. John Brownell start on Sunday against the Barnstormers, and Matt Larkins on Tuesday against the Skeeters. We're about the best of the bunch, but aside from that, it's been a fairly rough go of it for the starting pitchers. Runner goes, the 1-1 is skied foul again to the first base side, out of play. Abreu looking for his second stolen base of the year, but he will retreat to first. The count now even at 2 balls and 2 strikes. So as Kevin Baez said after yesterday's game, for the Ducks to be successful, it begins with their next day's starting pitcher. They will go with Tim Melville here in game one. As we see, Rafael Perez will start game two in his first game after missing two starts with a groin injury. 2-2 here, and this fouled back behind the plate. Out in front of that was Cuevas. John Brownell will face Jonathan Albaladejo on Saturday night, tomorrow evening, in a rematch of, again, the last two Atlantic League pitchers of the year. Albaladejo last year, Brownell two seasons ago. And then Matt Larkins will go on Sunday against Chris Rierich. So some good pitching matchups in this series. Tomorrow night certainly will be fun after Brownell earned the win out dueling Albaladejo last Tuesday. 2-2. And Cuevas takes low. This one gets past. Alex Berg goes to the backstop. And that will likely be Melville's second wild pitch of the inning. So that moves Abreu into scoring position. And now the count full on Cuevas. So three singles, a walk, and two wild pitches in this third inning. He has struck out two, but has allowed the Bluefish to retake the lead at 5-2 after the Ducks rallied on a two-out hit plus an error in the top of the third to tie the game at two. And now the payoff pitch to Jose Cuevas is swung on and popped up in the air towards second on the right side of the infield. Reyes and Kraus converging. It's going to be Reyes who makes the call and the catch. And that is going to retire the side. But not before the Bluefish take the lead back. They get three runs in this third inning on three hits, no errors, but a couple wild pitches and a walk in there. And one runner left on base. We played three here at the ballpark at Harbor Yard. It's the Bluefish 5 and the Ducks 2.
Hey fans, this is infielder Elmer Reyes, and you're listening to Duck Baseball on the Long Island Ducks Broadcast Network.
M&V Limousines is the official bus company of the Long Island Ducks. Family-owned and operated, they've been in the business for over 24 years. M&V Limousines offers coach buses with Wi-Fi and restrooms, party buses, exotic limousines, and also recently acquired Hampton Luxury Liner with regular service from New York City to the Hamptons. They also offer a variety of vineyard tour options. Whether you're looking for transportation for weddings, proms, corporate outings, or long-distance trips, they've got the right vehicle for you. Visit their showroom in Comac or check them out online at mvlimo.com. M&V Limousines and Hampton Luxury Liner, the official bus company of the Long Island Ducks.
Family fun every time.
Beautiful evening for baseball.
Big action every time.
He reaches up. It's gone!
Great value every time.
And the Ducks have won it 7-1.
The Ducks schedule is loaded with new promotions this season. And with an average ticket price of just $10 and free parking, there is no better value on Long Island. For game times and tickets, visit liducks.com. Long Island Ducks Baseball. Good times every time.
Well, Corey Rudin retakes the mound for the fourth inning. His Bluefish are now ahead of the Ducks by a count of 5-2. Their largest lead of the game after at one point leading it 2-0. Ducks rally to tie it, but the Bluefish are back in front. And with Ford, Kraus, and Berg, 4, 5, and 6 in the order due up, it is also time for our fourth inning trivia, where we test your knowledge of the Long Island Ducks, the Atlantic League, and baseball as a whole. Lou Ford to begin. And he swings first pitch and pops it up to the right side of the infield, foul territory. Sean Burroughs, the first baseman along the line, will make the catch. And Ford retired on one pitch for the first out of this fourth inning. He's now 0 for 2. Well, let's see how much you paid attention to the World Baseball Classic this year. We mentioned last night, and Chris King sort of talked about this on the broadcast. Last night, Giovanni Alfonso hit the second double of his professional career. This is his third season. His only other double came on July 30th, 2016, last year. Now, in that game, he was playing at third base for the Single-A Greensboro. That is the Greensboro Grasshoppers. They are the Single-A affiliate of the Miami Marlins. First pitch here to Mark Kraus is taken for a strike. And they were facing the Kannapolis Intimidators, who are the Single-A affiliate of the Chicago White Sox. We want to know who Alfonso hit the triple off of, and we will give you a hint. The hint is coming up after this 0-1 pitch to Mark Kraus. He swings. It's a high, towering fly ball into left field. jogging in on it, Daniel Fields. He will make the catch off to his side. Cross retired. And two fly balls have resulted in two outs quickly here in the fourth. The hint is that this past offseason, the pitcher that gave up the triple to Alfonso was pitching for Team Israel in the World Baseball Classic. So again, which pitcher allowed the only other triple prior to last night that Giovanni Alfonso hit in his career? And the hint is that he pitched for Team Israel in the World Baseball Classic and last year was a member of the Single-A Kannapolis Intimidators. Alex Berg takes the first pitch, breaking ball at the knees for strike one. We'll let you think about it. We'll give you the answer in the bottom half of this fourth inning. Does have a little bit of a personal connection, too, so I'll tell you about that when we give you the answer. 0-1 on the way to Berg, who flew out to deep left center his first time up. Hits another fly ball towards shallow left center this time. Long run in for Darby Myers, but he gets to the spot and makes the catch. And on five pitches, Corey Reardon is able to retire the Ducks in the fourth after the three-run third for Bridgeport. So the Ducks go in order quickly, and we go to the bottom of the fourth with the Bluefish still in front, 5-2.
Hey fans, this is infielder Giovanni Alfonso, and you're listening to Ducks Baseball on Long Island Ducks Broadcast Network.
Long Island's Ford Giant is celebrating its 60th year anniversary. Stop by Sayville Ford to check out their state-of-the-art showroom featuring enclosed service drives, luxurious customer lounge, and a larger selection to choose from. Get giant savings on hundreds of new and used vehicles in stock. Sayville Ford's 60th anniversary celebration is going on now. Visit SaylvilleFord.com or download the Sayville Ford app today to learn more about Sayville Ford's 60th anniversary savings. Call 631-589-4800 today.
Bethpage Ballpark is a great place to watch a ball game, so why not do so from some of the best seats in the house? The Ducks are proud to present the brand new Long Island Ducks Beer Garden. Open for all fans on nights when the Smokin' Owl's party deck has not been reserved, the Beer Garden will feature a variety of frosty draft and bottled brews, as well as several food choices. The area has been decked out with bar rail seating and Ducks-branded furniture to provide a comfortable atmosphere for everyone. Be sure to stop by and check out the brand new Long Island Ducks Beer Garden on your next visit to the ballpark. After a quick five-pitch top half of the inning by Corey Reardon, Tim Melville, who was on the mound for a long bottom of the third, having to face seven batters in the inning, has to return quickly to the mound here for the fourth. And he will face Guillen, Hernandez, and Myers. We're going to let you take this bottom half of the fourth inning as well to think about our trivia question. The top half of the inning was just not enough time for you to think about it and give an answer. So again, we will let you think about it, and then we'll give you the answer as we go to the top half of the fifth inning. If you think you know it, feel free to post a comment on our Facebook Live or YouTube feed. And if you are correct, we'll give you a special shout-out here on the airwaves. The Ducks, meanwhile, have to find a way to keep this Bluefish offense off the scoreboard. After a scoreless first inning, Bridgeport plated two runs in the second, an RBI single by Jose Cuevas, a pass ball scoring the runs, and then three more in the third on a two-run double by Sean Burrows and an RBI single by Tony Abreu. So it's a 5-2 Bluefish lead. They're also out hitting the Ducks 5-2 in this game. First pitch on the way is taken high and outside by the nine-hitter and right fielder Osni Guillen. And the count goes to 1-0 on Guillen, who popped out to center field in his first at-bat of the night. Melville winds and fires the 1-0. That's skied in the air to left, shallow towards the line. Long run out for the shortstop, Dan Lyons. In a foul ground, he makes the catch. Excellent running grab for Dan Lyons, once again showing off his terrific range. And Guillen retired for the first out of this fourth inning. That had shades of Derek Jeter going into the stands back in 2004 against the Red Sox, although here, I don't think that's even possible. You have a much higher wall that protects the seating bowl from the playing surface. Lyons would have to literally jump high in the air just to try and get into the seats. And in that instance, he had a little bit more room and more time to stop himself. First pitch is taken on the inside corner for strike one by Luis Hernandez. So Guillen is now 0-2. Hernandez, meanwhile, 0-1 with a walk and a fly out to left. And this pitch is lifted in the air to right center field. That is also shallow. Sanko, Cleary Jr. both converging, and it's Cleary Jr., the center fielder, who makes the catch. So two quick outs induced by Melville here in the fourth. That's exactly what he needs, a quick inning. And he's got two outs quickly here in the fourth. And that'll leave it up to Darby Myers. Two outs on four pitches for Melville after his pitch count skyrocketed in inning number three. So at 65 pitches entering this inning, now at 69. The Ducks certainly need length out of him today. The first pitch on the way to Darby Myers, and that swung on and missed as he chased a breaking ball low and outside, nothing and one. The Ducks had to use three different relievers last night in Treese, Kreider, and Diaz in relief of Henry Hirsch, who gave the Ducks what they needed of five innings. The 0-1, this is line into right field, a base hit for Darby Myers. So Myers picks up the two-out single. And he's got his first hit of the day following a flyout and a walk. And you don't want to give up a base hit to him with two outs, with Heel and Burrows behind him. But that is what happens. And now Jose Heel will step to the plate. Kevin Baez saying before the game, along with Billy Horn, that they do not have Zach Treese available today, as he threw two innings of relief yesterday and allowed three runs. They are also likely without Patrick Kreider. If he pitches today, it would be a third straight day, and the Ducks want to avoid that. Kreider said he would be able to go, but again, if needed in an emergency, he would pitch. The Ducks hoping that they don't. He didn't have to throw many pitches yesterday, but again, he did pitch the day before. And getting up and down certainly is taxing on a pitcher. 1-0 on Heel, who singled to right his last time up and popped to right his first time in the first inning. Here comes a 1-0 delivery. And the pitch on the way, runner bluffed. Pitch was taken low, a snap throw to first, and a good scoop on the backhand out of the dirt by Mark Krause to save the error from Berg. And it's 2-0 now on Jose Heel. Meanwhile, Tyler Levine and Rob Rogers still out of action after having to throw multiple innings in the previous game, that 13-1 loss to Sugarland on Wednesday night. And so that leaves Fuller available out of the bullpen, Diaz and Sal as the three relievers available here in game one of the doubleheader. 2-0, taken in the outside corner for a strike, throw down to second base, not in time. And in there safely with a stolen base is Darby Myers. Dan Lyons tried to apply the slap tag down at second base, but a nice job by Myers to sneak in as the ball kind of bounced on Lyons that had to lift his glove up to catch it, and by that point, Myers was able to sneak in. Seventh steal of the year for Myers. And now 2-1 on Heel is now the runner into scoring position. So Myers now 7 of 9. Melville gets the sign from Bergen, comes set. Looks back to second, now the 2-1 pitch. Heel takes a fastball on the inside corner for strike two. As we mentioned earlier, Dennis O'Grady, who was scratched from yesterday's start due to an illness before the game, he is feeling much better today. The plan is to have him back up Rafael Perez in game two of the doubleheader this evening. 2-2, and Heel swings and grounds one foul, a breaking ball by Melville. And Heel grounds it back behind home plate. We'll do it again at 2 balls and 2 strikes. And the Sella train rolls across the train tracks from right to left here in Bridgeport as Melville trying to get through this fourth inning without any further damage. Got the first two batters out, but has allowed a single and a steal to Darby Myers. And now the 2-2 pitch on the way to Jose Heel. Here it comes, and Heel takes a fastball, just missing the bottom of the strike zone. And that runs the count full at 3-2. Don't expect the runner to go here with a full count. Not a force play. First base is open, but you have the dangerous Sean Burrows waiting in the on-deck circle. Melville trying to get out number three right here. Does not want to face Burrows with two on. We saw what happened last inning when that was the case. And Burrows hit a two-run double over the head of Angelo Sanko in right. So So it'll be a 3-2 here to Jose Hill. Melville, who had stepped off, now looks in for the sign from Alex Berg. Here comes the payoff pitch. And Melville fires to the plate. Heels check swing. They say that he went around. The home plate umpire, Matt Hensel, making the call. Jose Hill started to jog towards first base, not realizing that he had strike three, but indeed he is out. And that's strikeout number three for Tim Melville. So in the fourth inning, no runs, one hit, and one left on base for the Bluefish. Let's head to the fifth here in game one of this single admission doubleheader, Bluefish 5 and the Ducks 2.
Hey fans, this is pitcher Matt Larkins, and you're listening to Ducks Baseball on the Long Island Ducks Broadcast Network.
PSEG Long Island is making things work for you with over 10 energy efficiency programs that can help you save on your monthly electric bill. From our free online energy analyzer and in-home energy assessments to rebates on energy-efficient air conditioning, even discounts on LED light bulbs. Helping you save on electricity is our job. What to do with your savings?
Flight 85, now boarding for the magic of Orlando.
Is entirely up to you. Visit PSEGLINY.com/save money. Just one more way PSEG Long Island is making things work for you.
Take your group out to the ball game this season and enjoy all the fun of Ducks baseball at discounted prices with the picnic area, luxury suites, the Smokin' Owls party deck, and so much more. Bringing your group to the game will be an unforgettable experience. The Ducks even offer opportunities to sing the national anthem, serve as the Ridgewood Savings Bank color guard, be the Nickelock Dream Team, put on a pregame performance, or shag fly balls during Ducks batting practice. To book your outing today, call 631-940-3825 and ask for the group sales department. Long Island Ducks Baseball. Good times every time.
Top of the fifth coming up here in Bridgeport, Connecticut. 5-2, the Bluefish leading the Ducks. All right, it is time for the answer to our trivia question, which we gave you in the top half of the fourth inning, where we test your knowledge of the Long Island Ducks, the Atlantic League, and baseball as a whole. First pitch on the way here is taken low. And the count goes to 1-0 on Delta Cleary Jr., who begins against Corey Reardon. The question once again, Giovanni Alfonso, last night his second triple of his career. First came July 30th last year, as Cleary Jr. takes the fastball, strike 1-1. Came as a member of the Greensboro Grasshoppers, single-A affiliate of the Marlins, against the Kannapolis Intimidator, single-A affiliate of the White Sox. 1-1 fastball hits the outside corner for strike two. We want to know which pitcher gave up the triple to Alfonso. 1-2 is lifted foul, third base side out of play. We gave you the hint that this past offseason, he was a member of Team Israel in the World Baseball Classic. The answer to the question, Alex Katz, a left-handed pitcher in the White Sox organization, who pitched in four games for Team Israel, did not allow a run in 3 1/3 innings. Cleary Jr., a ground ball to the right side, backhanded pickup by Sean Burroughs. He flips it to Reardon, covering in time for the out. Cleary Jr. retired. He's now 1-2, and there's the first out of this fifth inning. I told you there was a little bit of a personal connection to Alex Katz. Well, believe it or not, back when I was a bit of a youngster, back in my high school days, Alex Katz was a middle schooler, and we both happened to be members of the same temple on Long Island. That is Temple Tikva in New Hyde Park. And Alex Katz, a student, and yours truly, a Hebrew tutor, not necessarily a Hebrew language tutor, but more so the prayers and things like that that you need to become bar mitzvah. First pitch is taken on the outside corner for a strike, nothing and one. And sure enough, I had the privilege of tutoring Alex at the time. And now Alex has gone on to get drafted by the White Sox after a successful career pitching. As this is taken for a strike by Alfonso, nothing and two at Herricks High School in New Hyde Park. And then at St. John's University, got drafted by the White Sox. He's pitching in the White Sox organization, although recently I believe he got traded to the Orioles organization, if my memory serves correct. The 0-2 fastball misses high to Alfonso, 1-2. But, of course, had the ultimate honor of pitching for Team Israel during their memorable run in this past World Baseball Classic. Reardon's 1-2 pitch. Alfonso hits a ground ball back up the middle in the center field right off the second base bag. Giovanni Alfonso picks up the Ducks' third hit of the ball game. He is now 1-for-2. So the Ducks with a runner on with one out here in the fifth. And that'll bring up the shortstop and nine hitter Dan Lyons. So a nice little personal connection there. I'm sure probably more information than you were looking for as a listener, but still a cool story for me to tell, and I'm happy to see him going on and pitching as he continues his professional career. Maybe one day we'll be seeing Alex Katz pitching in the major leagues. Maybe one day we'll see Giovanni Alfonso up in the major leagues, just like his uncle Edgardo Alfonso once was. First pitch breaking ball is taken low and outside by Dan Lyons, 1-0. Lyons drew a walk with one out in the third and eventually scored a run that tied the game when a single to center field by Elmer Reyes was booted by Darby Myers. Bluefish though with a 5-2 lead right now. And the 1-0 from Reardon. Lyons takes a fastball outside. And the count 2-0. As we mentioned, Reardon does not walk many. He has walked only one in this game and has struck out three. That single by Alfonso broke up a streak of five straight retired by Reardon after that base hit with two outs from Elmer Reyes in the third inning. Here's the 2-0. Lyons is swinging a foul ball over the screen back behind the plate. This goes out of play and it's 2-1. Second baseman Jose Cuevas shaded towards the middle of the infield here. Shadows covering up the home plate area, but the pitcher's mound is still in the sun. And the 2-1, swing and a miss. Good cut by Lyons, but he was a bit out in front. Swings through the pitch. And that will even up the count at 2 balls and 2 strikes. Getting the sign and coming set is Reardon. Alfonso leads from first, the 2-2, and Lyons fouls it straight back to the screen. Good cut by Dan Lyons, and just missed it. So we will do it once again with the count at 2-2. Reardon comes set on the hill. A quick throw over to first to chase Alfonso back. Alfonso has good speed, but he has only successfully stolen one base this year. He's been caught twice. We'll see with two strikes if he's put in motion. I think only if it gets to 3-2. Here's the pitch, and Lyons swings, grounds this one to the left side and through a base hit. Alfonso goes to second. He'll stop as Fields will pick it up and flip it back in. So Dan Lyons picks up a single through the left side, his first hit of the game. Back-to-back one-out singles for the Ducks here in inning number 5. And that will bring the tying run to the plate in the form of Anthony Vega. So the Ducks have two on the base paths against Reardon. Here is Anthony Vega, who has struck out twice in this game. Had a hit and a walk in his first two plate appearances last night in his first game. Since over the weekend, he had been missing time due to a quad strain. But the quad feeling better, and he is back in the lineup. Here is the first pitch from Reardon, and Vega takes a fastball that misses down and away, 1-0. So a chance here for the Ducks. Obviously, a 3-run home run is ideal, but ultimately, they just want to keep the line moving and start cutting into this 3-run deficit. Still plenty of time to go in this game, top of the fifth of a scheduled 7-inning game. 1-0, and Vega takes a breaking ball that misses down low. Catcher Jose Hill couldn't find it, but he does pick it up. No movement from the runners. And a good hitter's count now for Anthony Vega. 2 balls and no strikes. During the last series between these two teams, Anthony Vega did get playing time a little bit. He was 1-for-4 with a stolen base. Coming into this game, has hit safely in 3 straight games. 2-0. Vega swings, lifts a high pop-up foul, third base side. This will go back into the seats. Ball bounces off of the lower concourse and is knocked down by a fan. Vega was ready to hack here at 2-0. Now 2 balls and a strike on the Ducks left fielder. Alfonso Alfonso with good speed at second. Lyons with good speed at first. Burrows playing behind Lyons at first base. The 2-1. Vega takes a fastball that catches the outside corner knee high for a strike. So that evens things up at 2-2. We've got Vega at the plate, Reyes on deck. As the Ducks are looking to cut into this three-run deficit. Outfield playing straight away for the lefty hitter. And the 2-2. That misses outside. Reardon trying to paint the corner with a fastball. So now the count full at 3-2. Don't think you'll see the runners moving here in case Vega strikes out, which he can do. And you've got an open lane to third base for the catcher, Jose Heel. Good speed, though, on the bases. Alfonso takes his lead, as does Lyons. Reardon looks in for the sign from Heel. Here comes the payoff pitch. It's on the way, and Vega swings and hits a high pop-up to the left side of the infield. Crossing into foul ground, the third baseman Abreu. Ball comes back fair, though, and Abreu makes the catch. So Anthony Vega pops up to third base for the second out of this fifth inning. And once again, Elmer Reyes will come to the plate with two on and two out. Well, a chance for Reyes to come up clutch again like he did in the third inning. Came up with Cleary Jr. at second, Lyons at first with two away, and on a two-strike pitch, he was able to dunk a single in the center to play Cleary Jr. First pitch here is a breaking ball at the knees for strike one, and then when the ball was misplayed by Myers, Lyons, who was running hard, scored all the way from first. Reyes with a chance here once again to come up with a two-out hit. Reardon looking in for the sign, now comes set. The 0-1, and Reyes swings, pops it up in the air down the right field line, slicing foul, Burrows over towards the seats, he'll run out of room. As it lands about 7 or 8 rows back, and now Elmer Reyes behind in the count, nothing and two. Reardon at 69 pitches for this game, 46 of them for strikes. Trying to record the final strike and final out of this time of the fifth inning and keep the 3-run lead intact for the Bluefish. Reyes digs back in at home plate. Here comes the 0-2 delivery. Reardon fires and Reyes swings. It's a ground ball to the left side, and it's grabbed there by the third baseman Abreu, and his throw to second base beats a sliding Lyons. Good play by Abreu to get that ball in the hole and save a run from scoring. So the Ducks threatened, but they are unable to close the gap further. For Long Island, no runs, two hits, and two left on base. Through 4.5 innings, the Bluefish still in front, 5-2.
Hey fans, this is Yuri De La Rosa, left-hander pitcher, and you are listening to Ducks Baseball on the Long Island Ducks Broadcast Network.
Hey Ducks fans, the official hotel of the Long Island Ducks is the Radisson Hotel Hopog Long Island. It's centrally located on the north shore of Long Island and offers a home away from home for both business and leisure guests. The Radisson Hotel Hopog Long Island features an indoor pool, 24-hour business center, a fitness center, and complimentary Wi-Fi in all guest rooms. Enjoy the contemporary American cuisine at the Fountain Grill restaurant or grab a quick bite to eat at Cafe Prato. And best of all, it's only minutes away from Bethpage Ball. Park. The Radisson Hotel Hopog Long Island, the official hotel of the Long Island Ducks. Call 631-231-1100 today. That's 631-231-1100.
Hey Ducks fans, stay up to date with Long Island's hometown team by visiting Quack of the Bat, the official blog of the Long Island Ducks. Quack of the Bat will bring Ducks fans beyond the headlines with in-depth feature articles, breaking news stories, game previews, post-game wrap-ups, and so much more. Interact with the team during the entire season through quotes directly from the players and coaches, as well as exclusive video clips and photos. Check out the blog today at quackofthebat.wordpress.com. Quack of the Bat, the official blog of the Long Island Ducks. Ducks fans, chill out all summer long with a cold cup of Hampton Coffee Company Gourmet Iced Coffee. It's available at the concession stands at Bethpage Ballpark. Hampton Coffee is the preferred coffee of the Long Island Ducks. Visit HamptonCoffeeCompany.com or check out their cafes. in the Hamptons. Michael Pollock here with you at the ballpark at Harbor Yard in Bridgeport, Connecticut. The Long Island Ducks trailing the Bridgeport Bluefish 5-2 as we move to the bottom of the fifth. Sean Burrows will lead off against Tim Melville. And the first pitch is lined into left center field on the run over Anthony Vega. He'll make the running catch. One pitch, one out, as Tim Melville is able to retire Burrows to begin this fifth inning. Burrows now 1-for-3. He had the two-run double to right in the third that gave the Bluefish the lead back at 4-2. They now lead 5-2. So one away, and that'll bring up the designated hitter, Jonathan Galvez. One other game has just begun. That is down in Waldorf, Maryland, where the Blue Crabs hosting the Bees. Top of the first inning, and they are scoreless. Gabby Hernandez getting the start for Southern Maryland, and Anthony Marzi gets the start for New Britain. First pitch misses for ball one to Jonathan Galvez here, with the bases empty and one out. Galvez in this game is 0-for-1 with a walk, a strikeout, and a run. The 1-0. That swung on and missed. Good slider that time from Tim Melville. Cut through by Galvez, 1-1. At 7 o'clock, the Patriots will host the Skeeters in Bridgewater, New Jersey. David Kubiak, the former Bluefish, goes for Somerset. Brett Marshall for Sugarland. This one grounded to short. Charging in his Lions, he fields and throws to first in time. So Jonathan Galvez is retired on the ground after short. Two quick outs again for Melville here in the third inning. Also later on tonight at 7 o'clock in Lancaster. I'll check that. It looks like that game has just gotten underway. It is the, I believe this is the first meeting of the year between the in-state rivals, the York Revolution and the Lancaster Barnstormers. They are in the top of the first. Barnstormers and Revolution, War of the Roses matchup. They're scoreless. Former Duck Jared Leverett goes for Lancaster. Frank Gailey goes for York in a matchup of southpaws. First pitch here is taken for a strike, nothing and one. Tony Abreu has an RBI single and a fly out to left in his two at-bats. 0-1, swing and a miss. Melville got him to chase the slider. And the count goes to nothing and two. Yankees will visit the Blue Jays again tonight after their win last night. Michael Pineda for the Yankees, Francisco Liriano for the Blue Jays. Mets hosting the Pirates at 7:10. Matt Harvey for the Mets, Garrett Cole for Pittsburgh. 0-2 fastball is way upstairs off the glove of Alex Berg. And the count 1-2. New York Liberty are at Madison Square Garden tonight to take on the Dallas Wings in WNBA action. Quick look at the out-of-town scoreboard there. Here the Ducks trailing 5-2 to the Bridgeport Bluefish in the opening game of this single admission doubleheader and the first of four this weekend here at the ballpark at Harbor Yard. Melville's 1-2. And Abreu a swing and a miss, strike three. Foul tipped that one into the glove of Alex Berg. So there's a 1-2-3 inning for Tim Melville, the first time he is able to retire the Bluefish in order in this game. He's now got four strikeouts on the night. And that means this is a PSEG Long Island energy efficient inning. With energy efficiency programs from PSEG Long Island, saving on your electric bill is also as easy as 1-2-3. Visit PSEGLINY.com/save money. One more way, PSEG Long Island is making things work for you. We head to the sixth here in Bridgeport, 5-2, Bluefish in front.
Giovanni Alfonso, and you're listening to Ducks Baseball on Long Island Ducks Broadcast Network.
PSEG Long Island is making things work for you with over 10 energy efficiency programs that can help you save on your monthly electric bill. From our free online energy analyzer and in-home energy assessments to rebates on energy-efficient air conditioning, even discounts on LED light bulbs. Helping you save on electricity is our job. What to do with your savings?
Flight 85, now boarding for the Magic of Orlando.
Is entirely up to you. Visit PSEGLINY.com/save money. Just one more way PSEG Long Island is making things work for you.
Back here in Bridgeport, Connecticut, as we head to the sixth inning. Ducks taking on the Bluefish. Five runs, six hits, and one error for the Bluefish. Two runs, four hits, and no errors for the Ducks. Fans follow all season long as the Long Island Ducks try to meet the Chappies Home Run Challenge. If the Ducks hit 100 home runs this season, then Chappies Funeral Homes will donate $5,000 to the Quacker Jack Foundation. Chappies Funeral Homes, where caring for others is our family tradition. Michael Pollock here with you in Bridgeport. And the Ducks, which got two runs on the board in the third to tie the game at two apiece, has not scored in the past two innings. And they stranded two on base in the fifth. So now it is Angelo Sanco to begin the sixth, and he hits one in the air to shallow right center field. Out goes the second baseman, and reaching out is Jose Cuevas, and he somehow made the catch. Or was it the shortstop Hernandez? One of the two come up with it, and there's the first out. Jose Cuevas and Luis Hernandez both went out in a shallow right center to try and grab that baseball off the bat of Angelo Sanco. And I think it was Hernandez who ended up coming up with it. But a spectacular play for the first out. Indeed, it was Hernandez. So Sanco bidding for a bloop base hit to begin the sixth inning, but he is now 0 for 3. In fact, he's been robbed twice in this game of hits. Once in the first on a nice running catch by the right fielder, Osni Guillen. So one away, and now Luke Ford to the plate in the cleanup spot tonight. First pitch is a fastball taken above the belt for ball one. Ford a strikeout victim in the second inning, one of three that Corey Reardon has picked up in this game. Then popped out foul the first and the fourth. Here he hits a high pop-up foul behind the plate, and this will go out of play. That'll even things up at one and one. Well, Reardon trying to make it three straight starts of three earned runs or less. He did allow five runs two starts ago, but only three of them were earned. And, of course, three earned runs his last time out against Somerset, May 28th. 1-1, Ford takes low, and the count goes to two balls and one strike. His season high was five. He did that his first outing of the year in Sugar Land on April the 20th, pitching on opening night for the Bluefish. And a 5-2 loss to the defending champs. Here, Ford hits a high pop-up down the left field line. Foul ground, Abreu gives it a look, but this will go back into the seats out of play. And that will even things up at two balls and two strikes on the Ducks' designated hitter. Ducks a very different look in certain aspects to where they were last time that they came here. Nolan Reimold and Cody Puckett no longer with the team. Puckett out for the season with a knee injury, and Reimold has elected to retire. 2-2. Ford a fly ball down the right field line that is foul. Lou Ford is here. He was not the last time the Ducks were here. Also with the Ducks are the three bench players that they have who were not here the last time the Ducks visited a couple weeks ago. Or actually, that was last week, now that I think about it. It was last Tuesday and Wednesday, May 23rd and 24th. Pacheco, Floridas, and Goldstein all signed during the past homestand. 2-0 is a swing and a miss for strike three. Ford cuts through the high fastball. Strikeout number four for Reardon. And there's the second out of this sixth inning. Again, those three taking spots of other guys that had held roster spots. Again, Cody Puckett no longer with the team, as he is out with an injury. Nolan Reimold electing to retire. Dominic Blanco was released. And as we mentioned, Phelan Lentini is on the inactive list for the moment, as he is away tending to family matters. First pitch is taken on the outside corner for a strike to Mark Krause. Nothing and one. Krause has popped out to left twice in this game. And the middle of the order for the Ducks, actually there are 3, 4, 5, and 6 hitters in this game, a combined 0 for 10. Obviously that a problem, the 0-1. And Krause hits a fly ball down the left field line, fouling out of play. And Reardon quickly ahead, nothing and 2. Reyes in the top two of the order has a hit, otherwise they are 1 for 6. And it's been the bottom of the order that's done the most damage for the Ducks. Cleary Jr., Alfonso, and Lyons each with a hit. And Lyons has also drawn a walk. This pitch taken high and outside. And the count goes to 1-2. There's no question that the Ducks' offense has been struggling a bit of late, and they certainly need to get going to try and get wins on the left side of their record. It'll be up to the middle of the offense certainly to help provide that. The 1-2, and Krause takes a breaking ball on the outside corner for strike three. Corey Reardon picks up his fifth strikeout of the ball game, second of the inning, and the Ducks go in order in the sixth. So we will head to the bottom half of inning number six, Long Island trailing Bridgeport 5-2.
Hey fans, this is infielder Mark Krause, and you're listening to Ducks Baseball on the Long Island Ducks Broadcast Network.
Oh, I love it. The color of my new Nicolat patio is so vibrant. It's unlike anything I've ever seen.
You're welcome.
I'm just going to go finish that Nikolok walkway now.
Make your pavers Vivid Nikolok Pavers. The best looking, most vibrant pavers with the most three color blends in the industry. Featuring Nikolok's exclusive paver shield and color blending technology with color throughout and guaranteed not to fade. Live life in color with Nikolok. Visit Nikolok.com.
Have your birthday at the ballpark this season and celebrate with the flock. Kona Ice birthday party packages with the Long Island Ducks are now available. Each package includes 10 box seats, a commemorative birthday t-shirt and autographed baseball, a pizza and Kona Ice party in the Hebrew National picnic area, and so much more. Best of all, the birthday child will stand on the dugout while the entire crowd sings happy birthday. Reserve your party today by calling the group sales department at 631-940-3825. Kona Ice birthday parties with the Long Island Ducks, a once-in-a-lifetime experience. Tim Melville back out for his sixth inning of work here in game one of this doubleheader. Long Island Ducks trailing 5-2. The Ducks will look to keep Bridgeport with those five runs and then give the offense a chance to rally in the top of the seventh. Again, a reminder, this is a single admission doubleheader today, so 2 7-inning games, the first game of which is a makeup from the game that was postponed last Thursday, May the 25th here in Bridgeport due to inclement weather. And so the team's playing two today to make up for that instead of just the one originally scheduled game at 7:12. The series will continue tomorrow night at 6:12 with game three of the set and then conclude Sunday afternoon at 1:12. Ducks will enjoy an off day on Monday and then they will head up to New Britain, Connecticut, where they will take on the Bees in a three-game series Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. First pitch on the way here from Melville. It misses the outside corner for ball one. And it's very rare to say this, but the Ducks will have a lot of road games in the month of June. The Ducks have gone 10-8 on the road thus far this season compared to just 9-13 at home. Here a breaking ball taken for a strike, 1-1. That's very odd to see. When you look back at the history for the Ducks and their home and road splits, they have traditionally been a much better home team. A 1-1 is lifted foul down the left field line out of play. 1-2. In fact, the Ducks have never had a losing record at home in their 17 years prior to this one. They have always at least been at 500. That was their worst home year. That was 2010. They went 35-35. 1-2. Swing and a miss. Strike three. Melville blows the fastball by the lefty swinging Daniel Fields. So there's strikeout number five for Melville. Again, he's racking up a lot of strikeouts. Five in this game. He has walked three, though, and ultimately has allowed five runs, four of them earned, on a total of six hits. So one away, and that'll bring up the righty-swinging Jose Cuevas. But again, the Ducks just with nine home games during the month of June and two very short homestands. First pitch is chopped into the ground foul. And the count nothing and one. Ducks will have a three-game set against these Bluefish next weekend, June 9th, 10th, and 11th. And then they will welcome in the Somerset Patriots at Bethpage Ballpark a little bit later, June 19th through the 22nd. But aside from that, yesterday's series finale and the first game of a series against Southern Maryland on June the 30th. Everything else on the road during this month. And the 0-1 is a breaking ball taken at the knees for a strike, nothing and two. Now the Ducks who come into this game 5.5 games in back in the Liberty Division certainly going to need to continue to pick up wins on the road here in this month to try and rally back in the division race. 0-2 is a fastball that misses high. And now 1-2 on Cuevas, who is 1-for-2 with an RBI single and a pop out to second. Melville winds and fires, and now the 1-2 pitch is another fastball well up high. Looks as though David Carpenter has begun to warm in the bullpen down the right field line, so Corey Reardon likely done after six innings of two-run ball. And the closer Carpenter will probably come in to pitch the seventh and try and nail down the save. 2-2 from Melville, and Cuevas grounds this one to third. A big hop for Giovanni Alfonso, who fields and throws across the diamond in time for the out. So Cuevas retired on the 5-3 put out, two away, and Melville has now retired six in a row since the single by Myers in the fourth. 10 of the last 11 have been set down by Melville since the RBI singled by Tony Abreu. So Melville has certainly settled in here after the rough start. But the Ducks offense, after their two-run third inning, has gone quiet over the last three, managing just two singles in that span. First pitch here to Osney Guillen, lifted in the air to center. Jogging back towards left center, Delta Cleary Jr. He'll make the catch. And back-to-back 1-2-3 innings for Tim Melville. Bluefish go in order. We head to the seventh. Last chance for the Ducks here in game one of the doubleheader as they trail by three.
Hey, fans. This is pitcher Dennis O'Grady, and you're listening to Ducks Baseball on the Long Island Ducks Broadcast Network.
M&V Limousines is the official bus company of the Long Island Ducks. Family owned and operated, they've been in the business for over 24 years. M&V Limousines offers coach buses with Wi-Fi and restrooms, party buses, exotic limousines, and also recently acquired Hampton Luxury Liner with regular service from New York City to the Hamptons. They also offer a variety of vineyard tour options. Whether you're looking for transportation for weddings, proms, corporate outings, or long distance trips, they've got the right vehicle for you. Visit their showroom in Comac or check them out online at mvlimo.com. M&V Limousines and Hampton Luxury Liner, the official bus company of the Long Island Ducks.
Family fun every time.
Beautiful evening for baseball.
Big action every time.
He reaches up. It's gone!
Great value every time.
And the Ducks have won it 7-1.
The Ducks schedule is loaded with new promotions this season. And with an average ticket price of just $10 and free parking, there is no better value on Long Island. For game times and tickets, visit liducks.com. Long Island Ducks Baseball. Good times every time.
Well, we head to the seventh here at the ballpark at Harbor Yard. The Ducks trailing the Bridgeport Bluefish 5-2 in game one of this doubleheader that is scheduled for seven innings. So Bridgeport has gone on to its closer, David Carpenter, who comes into the game in relief of Corey Reardon, who is in line for the victory. If the Bluefish hold on, he would improve to 3-2. Melville would drop to 2-4 for Long Island. Melville, who gave the Ducks six innings of five-run ball tonight, only four of those runs earned, stands in line to get the loss. And after a rough couple of innings, he settled in nicely in the fourth, fifth, and sixth. But ultimately, the Ducks offense, after getting those two runs on two hits and an error in the third, along with a walk, have managed just two singles since. And now Carpenter will come on to try and pick up the save for Long Island. It will be Berg, Cleary Jr., and Alfonso due up to the plate. First pitch on the way from Carpenter. And Alex Berg takes a fastball strike over the outside corner, nothing and one. Berg in this game 0 for 2 with a pair of flyouts to left center. This is appearance number 20 on the year for Carpenter, trying to pick up save number 16 on the season. He leads the league in that category as Berg takes outside this time and leaving up the count at 1-1. Berg had missed the entire Sugarland series. He had hurt his bicep during batting practice on Tuesday, so did not play in any of the three games against the Skeeters. But he is back and ready to play, 1-1, and he checks his swing, but home plate umpire Matt Hensel says that Berg went around. And so Alex Berg now behind in the count at 1-2 against Carpenter. Going on the season has a 1-1 record and a 1.04 earned run average. Former major leaguer, former New York Yankee, excelling in his second season here with Bridgeport. 1-2. Berg takes low and outside. Good eye. Now we'll even things up at two balls and two strikes. Nothing doing for the Ducks right now in their bullpen. I don't think you'll see anybody up unless the Ducks start to get some runners on base. 2-2 delivery. And Berg is swinging a miss way late on the fastball down in the zone for strike three. There is the first strikeout for Carpenter, one away here in the seventh inning. On the final line on Corey Reardon, he goes six innings, gives up four hits, two runs, one of which was earned, the other unearned because of the error by Darby Myers in the third. Walked one and struck out five, and again he is in line to get the victory for the Bluefish. Delta Cleary Jr. to the plate now. He's one for two on this ball game. The first pitch. Fastball hits the inside corner for strike one. Cleary Jr. singled to center to begin the third inning, stole second and scored on the base hit by Elmer Reyes. Then he grounded out back to the mound in the fifth inning. From the stretch, here's the 0-1. Kicking the pitch, Cleary Jr. takes way inside. That'll even things up at one ball and one strike. Carpenter's last outing for the Bluefish was on Wednesday night. He earned the save. Got the final out. Did give up a hit, though, against the New Britain Bees. Longest outing of the year was an inning in a third, May 21st, against Southern Maryland. 1-1 fastball is off the outside corner, taken by Cleary Jr. And the count goes to 2-1. It's been the bottom of the order that's done the damage in this game for the Ducks. Cleary Jr., Alfonso, and Lyons coming into this at bat, 3-for-5 in this game, with two runs and a walk. 2-1. Line down the left field line, foul. And the count 2-2. The rest of the order, the first six in the batting order for the Ducks, has just one hit in 18 at-bats in this game. That one hit was the base hit by Reyes that brought in both of the runs, but we got only one RBI. So it's now a two-ball, two-strike pitch from Carpenter to Cleary Jr. Right-hander fires, and Cleary Jr. a swing and a foul back to the screen. Good cut by the Ducks center fielder as he fights it off. Cleary Jr. trying to get on base here with two down and try and start up a rally against Carpenter in the seventh. Here's the 2-2 pitch. Half swing and a pitch up and away. They appeal to third. And Matthew Kane says he did not go. So Cleary Jr. gets the count full to 3-2. Now the Ducks would certainly take a walk here. They want to get two guys on at least here in this seventh inning to bring the tying run at the plate. We got Cleary Jr. at the plate now, Giovanni Alfonso on deck, and Dan Lyons in the hole. 3-2, Cleary Jr. a fly ball foul, third base side of home plate. This will go back into the seats. So that goes out of play, and we'll do it again at 3-2. Stands have definitely filled up a little bit as this game has gone on. By no means is it packed here, but more and more fans have continued to arrive, and we are about 10 minutes away from what the originally scheduled first pitch was. Another payoff pitch from Carpenter. Cleary Jr. takes on the inside corner, a called strike three. Good slider from Carpenter. Back-to-back strikeouts to begin the seventh inning for Carpenter. And now seven strikeouts for Bluefish pitching in this game. Ducks down to their final out here in the opener of the Twin Bill. And that'll bring Giovanni Alfonso to the plate.
Third base, 6,
Bluefish took the opening game of the doubleheader the last time these two teams faced, back on May the 24th. First pitch here to Alfonso is taken way outside for ball one. Bluefish won that game 2-0 behind a terrific start from Chris Rierich, who will start the finale on Sunday in this series. But the Ducks rallied in game two after falling behind 5-0 for their largest comeback win of the year as they won that game 7-5. Alfonso takes a strike on the outside corner. That'll even up the count at 1-1. Alfonso in this game is 1-for-2. He singled up the middle his last at bat. That was back in the fifth with one out and popped to right his first time up back in inning number three. 1-1. Fouled over the screen back behind the plate. That's out of play, and now Carpenter one strike away from nailing down his 16th save of the season. Bluefish leading it 5-2 here at the ballpark at Harbor Yard. Here is the 1-2 offering from Carpenter, and Alfonso swings. It's a ground ball towards short. Big hop for the shortstop, Hernandez. He fields, throws to first in time for the out. This ball game is over. And the Bridgeport Bluefish take game one of this single admission doubleheader by the final count of 5-2. So the Ducks go in order in the seventh inning. Bridgeport Bluefish pitching retires the final 8 Ducks hitters to come to the plate in this game. And Long Island's offense continues to struggle as the Bluefish win the game 5-2. Don't go anywhere. The postgame show is coming up next. We'll recap game one of this doubleheader. and hand out the Player of the Game award. Bluefish 5 and the Ducks 2.
Hey fans, this is Jim Fuller, left-handed pitcher, and you're listening to Ducks Baseball on the Long Island Ducks Broadcast Network.
Long Island's Ford Giant is celebrating its 60th year anniversary. Stop by Sayville Ford to check out their state-of-the-art showroom featuring enclosed service drives, luxurious customer lounge, and a larger selection to choose from. Get giant savings on hundreds of new and used vehicles in stock. Sayville Ford's 60th anniversary celebration is going on now. Visit SaylvilleFord.com or download the Sayville Ford app today to learn more about Sayville Ford's 60th anniversary savings. Call 631-589-4800 today.
Baseball fans, the Long Island Ducks mobile app has officially arrived. Powered by Clear Vision Apps, it's your one-stop shop for all things Ducks baseball. Buy tickets straight from your mobile device. Receive game status updates with push notifications. Check out up-to-the-minute news and scores and interact with the Ducks on social media. Best of all, it's free. Download the Ducks mobile app today by visiting the App Store on your Apple-powered device or Google Play on your Android-powered device. The Long Island Ducks mobile app, with you wherever you flock to. Well, to start the Ducks, we're looking forward to this four-game weekend set against the Bridgeport Bluefish as the Bluefish used a three-run third inning to take a 5-2 lead, and they hold on for that win, 5-2 over the Ducks in the opening game of this single admission doubleheader. They now even up the Ferry Cup series at two games apiece. Let's recap this game for you. After a scoreless first inning on each side, the Bluefish took the lead in the bottom of the second inning against Ducks starter Tim Melville. Jonathan Galvez walked to begin the inning. Leadoff walks were a problem for Melville. His first three innings, he walked the leadoff man. Then with one out, Daniel Field singled to left field, and Jose Cuevas followed with an RBI base hit to center. His 16th RBI brought in Galvez to make this a 1-0 game, and then a pass ball from Alex Berg allowed Fields to score from third, and that gave the Bluefish a 2-0 lead. The Ducks were able to rebound, though, in the third inning when Delta Cleary Jr. singled to open the inning, stole second base, and then with one out, Dan Lyons drew a walk to put runners at first and second. Anthony Vega struck out for the second out of the inning, but with two outs and two strikes on him, Elmer Reyes dunked a single in a right center field. The RBI base hit, Reyes' 16th RBI scored Cleary Jr., and then when the ball was misplayed in center by Darby Myers, Dan Lyons, who was running hard, scored all the way from first, and two runs on the board, even the score at two apiece. But in the third inning, the bottom half of the inning, the Bluefish came right back. A leadoff walk to Darby Myers and a single to Jose Heald, but two on with nobody out for Sean Burroughs. He squared to bunt twice to move the runners over, but couldn't get the bunt down. But with two strikes on him, he was able to foul off a pitch or two and then hit a double over the head of Angelo Sanco in right. His eighth double, RBI 17 and 18 of the year, brought in Myers and Heal. And that made it a 4-2 game. After a strikeout from Jonathan Galvez, Tony Abreu came to the plate. Burroughs went to third on a wild pitch and scored on the base hit to left by Abreu, his 20th RBI of the year. And that made it a 5-2 ball game. Tim Melville would settle in after that and allow just one more base runner from that point on over the next three innings plus, and that was a single by Myers in the fourth. But ultimately, the damage had been done at that point. The Ducks trailed 5-2, and Long Island managed just two singles from the fourth inning through the seventh, and those were the back-to-back hits by Alfonso and the Lions with one out in the fifth inning. But the final eight batters of the game were retired by Corey Reardon and David Carpenter, and the Bluefish picked up the win 5-2 here in the opening game of this doubleheader. Final totals for the game for the Ducks, two runs, four hits, no errors. They left three for the Bluefish, five runs on six hits and an error. They left four. The winning pitcher, Corey Reardon, improves to 3-2. The loser, Tim Melville, he drops to 2-4. And the save to David Carpenter, his 16th of the year. And the game took 1 hour and 50 minutes. We'll give you the attendance following game two of this single admission doubleheader. Player of the game here for game one of the doubleheader, Bluefish starter Corey Reardon, who gets the win. Six innings, four hits, two runs, one of which was earned. Walked one, struck out five, and threw a total of 81 pitches, 55 for strikes. He was dominant from the get-go, and after the little hiccup in the second, in the third, really settled down nicely and kept the Ducks at bay for the rest of the game. Take one more break when we come back, the out-of-town scores, and then we'll wrap things up here for game one of the doubleheader.
Hey fans, this is pitcher Tyler Wilson, and you're listening to Ducks Baseball on the Long Island Ducks Broadcast Network.
Long Island's Ford Giant is celebrating its 60th year anniversary. Stop by Sayville Ford to check out their state-of-the-art showroom featuring enclosed service drives, luxurious customer lounge, and a larger selection to choose from. Get giant savings on hundreds of new and used vehicles in stock. Sayville Ford's 60th anniversary celebration is going on now. Visit SaylvilleFord.com or download the Sayville Ford app today to learn more about Sayville Ford's 60th anniversary savings. Call 631-589-4800 today.
Have your birthday at the ballpark this season and celebrate with the flock. Kona Ice birthday party packages with the Long Island Ducks are now available. Each package includes 10 box seats, a commemorative birthday t-shirt and autographed baseball, a pizza and Kona Ice party in the Hebrew National picnic area, and so much more. Best of all, the birthday child will stand on the dugout while the entire crowd sings happy birthday. Reserve your party today by calling the group sales department at 631-940-3825. Kona Ice birthday parties with the Long Island Ducks, a once-in-a-lifetime experience. Back here at the ballpark at Harbor Yard, Tim Melville goes the distance all six innings that the Ducks pitching staff took the mound in this game, but ultimately it doesn't matter as the Bluefish win it 5-2 to take the opening game of this single admission doubleheader. Game two coming up probably about 25 to 30 minutes from now. We'll try and get an official start time for you, and we'll let you know what twitter.com/LIDucks. We'll also have the lineups for game two coming to you on Twitter and at the Ducks official blog, quackofthebat.wordpress.com, once we get them for you. But before we head out the door for game one of the doubleheader, let's give you the out-of-town scoreboard. All the games have started in the Atlantic League. Scoreless in Somerset, top of the first inning, the Patriots hosting the Skeeters. Brett Marshall starting tonight for the Sugarland Skeeters, and former Bluefish David Kubiak goes for the Somerset Patriots. Ducks now six games behind the Patriots in the Liberty Division. Bees one and the Blue Crabs nothing. Top of the second down in Waldorf, Maryland. A home run from John Griffin has put the Bees in front. Anthony Marzi starting for New Britain and Gabby Hernandez going for Southern Maryland. And meanwhile in Lancaster, Pennsylvania, the Barnstormers have jumped out to a 3-0 lead against their in-state rivals, the York Revolution. They play in the bottom of the second inning. Frank Gailey for York, Jared Leverett for Lancaster, Gindel and Hobson with the RBIs thus far for the Stormers. Yankees and the Mets are both about to get underway. Yankees visiting the Blue Jays up in Toronto, and the Mets are hosting the Pirates at Citi Field. Those games just getting underway. Garrett Cole for the Pirates and Matt Harvey for the Mets. Yankees, meanwhile, with Michael Pineda on the mound, Francisco Liriano going for the Yankees, and the Liberty at 7:30 will host the Wings of Dallas at Madison Square Garden. So that'll do it for the out-of-town scoreboard. Again, a quick look at Game 2 starting pitchers for the Ducks. It'll be left-hander Rafael Perez making his first start since May 19th when he exited after five innings against Somerset with a groin injury. He is 2-1 on the year, 3.73 ERA, had been pitching very well prior to that groin strain. The Ducks are hoping he will be able to pick up where he left off. Meanwhile, for the Bluefish, it will be right-hander Rainey Lara, the Ducks' first look at Lara, who is 3-1 on the year with a 2.67 ERA. He took the losses last time out, but has pitched very well this season for the Bluefish. Ducks here in their seventh doubleheader of the season already will look to try and salvage a split of this twin bill with Game 2 coming up about 25 minutes from now here in Bridgeport, Connecticut. So that's going to do it for us here in Game 1 of the doubleheader. Again, the final score, the Bluefish 5 and the Ducks 2. We invite you to join us once again in about 20-25 minutes for Game 2 of this doubleheader. The pregame show, a very abbreviated pregame show, will begin about 5 minutes prior to first pitch. Stay tuned here, though, on LIDucks.com and the Long Island Ducks Broadcast Network. We will have a separate feed coming to you, but it will be Game 2 on this same broadcast network. We'll have all the action of that 7-inning game. My name is Michael Pollack. Thank you so much for spending Game 1 of the doubleheader with me here on your Friday evening. Hope you enjoyed the broadcast. Have a great little break in between the two games, and we'll see you for Game 2 here momentarily from Bridgeport, Connecticut. Good evening from the ballpark at Harbor Yard.